Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 28th meeting of the Rural Affairs and Islands Committee in 2023. Before we begin, can I remind all those members using electronic devices to please turn them to silent. Our first item of business today is to decide whether the review of evidence heard during our pre-legislative scrutiny of future agricultural policy should be taken in private at our next meeting. Are we all agreed? Thank you. Our next item of business is an evidence session on future agricultural policy with representatives of major supermarkets in Scotland. Firstly, I would like to put on record that we did ask Tesco, Co-op and Aldi to join us in this session, and the reasons behind having these sessions were explained to them quite clearly, but very disappointingly, the three supermarkets declined our invitation. But I am delighted that this morning I can welcome to the meeting Chris Bowne, who's a Sustainable Business Director from ASDA, and Sophie Thorpe, who's the Technical and Sustainability Director in Manufacturing from Morrisons. Thank you. Thank you for joining us. We have approximately an hour this morning for questions. So I'm going to kick off. Can you give us your view on how the food supply chain typically operates in the UK, and the role of major retailers like yourself in the food chain? And I'll kick off with Chris.
Thank you, convener. I would say that the overall perspective will be it's a very successful food supply chain. If you think about the challenges which the UK food industry has faced in the past 20 years from BSE for foot and mouth, and yet in general, the food shelves in our shops have been well stocked. There's been availability of products. It might not be a complete range, but for most cases, there's not been. I'm sure US policymakers have not been challenged about the availability of food. So I think we've proven to be very robust and very responsive, both in terms of what's happening in the supply chain, but also in terms of changes in terms of customer purchasing habits and patterns. And, you know, we've managed to get through a global epidemic.
Can you just elaborate more on how you actually see the food supply operates in practice from the field to the plate?
I think that varies according to the supply chain. So in some instances, on livestock, for example, we operate through our processor, which for Scotland is ABP with their plant at Perth. And then they are taking from farmers who both supply dead weight, and in some instances coming in through auction markets. If you look to something like potatoes, ASDA operates its own potato packing plant, and that is supplied by two major grower groups. One is Scottish Potato Co-op, and the other is Tay Growers. They do over 90% of the supply into that pack house. And if you looked overseas, we would deal with farmer cooperatives, we would deal with the large brands. So there is no one size which fits all in this regard, Scavina, and it depends also in terms of what the supply chain and the suppliers are wanting. So we try and adapt to meet their requirements too.
Thank you. I'll now move on to Sophie. Can I pronounce your surname? Is it Thorpe?
It's Thorpe.
Thorpe. Thank you, Sophie. Could you give Morrison's perspective on the supply chain, please?
Yes, certainly. So for Morrison's, we're a little bit different in that we also have a big manufacturing business as well as supermarkets in Scotland. And so we have one of our manufacturing sites in Turriff in Aberdeen, where we're taking in beef and lamb. About 70% of the beef is only sort of like coming from within a sort of an hour's drive, and I think it's similar numbers for lamb as well. So that sort of structure that we have convenient within Morrison's means that we are buying directly from farmers. So we buy directly from about 900 Scottish farmers. So beef and lamb going direct to our own plants. In potatoes, we do sort of still take from about sort of predominantly about sort of six farms, or 34 farms, beg your pardon, through six groups. But they go down south of the border now to be packed in our own processing and packing facilities. We, however, don't sort of like manufacture and process everything ourselves, and so we do have long-standing relationships with growers, for example, and Duncan's Farms, who sort of supplies with all of our Scottish eggs, and Arla in Lockerbie for our milk, and Lactalis for cheese. So we sort of do try to think about working with the long-term relationships and with sort of companies on the ground, but where possible through our own facilities.
Thank you. Alistair Allen.
Thank you very much, Convener. And I share your disappointment, Convener, that some of the supermarkets haven't chosen to turn up. That's not something I can hold you responsible for, and I won't. But the figures I have are that 60% of the market in terms of food being sold, I think the figure refers to the UK rather than just Scotland, is in the hands of five retailers. But there are many towns across Scotland where, of course, you could replace that number five with two or with three. Is that a situation that can go on forever without people asking whether it's entirely healthy?
Do we have a go at that one first? I think that strikes me as being data related to the grocery market and not the food market. And of course, one of the things about the food industry, which perhaps should have said, convenient, it's an incredibly dynamic and progressive industry. We have home delivery services, we have the growth in internet retailing. And of course, a third of calories are consumed outside of the home, and there's also an enormous food market in public procurement too. In terms of where retail is, I think the retail market is a very competitive market, it's a very scrutinised market, and one which we're very open to that level of scrutiny. And we have also have, when it comes to supply relationships, the Grocery Code, which we comply with.
How does that picture in terms of market share compare with other European countries?
You'd have to look, but at the top of my head, you could look at Australia, where there's two major supermarket chains, Coles and Woolworths.
Okay. Thank you.
Yep, Sophie?
Yes, thank you. So just to add to that, so I would sort of say that sort of there is, of course, as well, a lot of competition within the grocery sector, which is actually for the benefit of consumers. And so, you know, we're able to, particularly as we are in the cost of living crisis at the moment, you know, extremely mindful about how customers can afford to access good British food. For ourselves, as Morrisons, we have 100% British sourcing policy, 100% British fresh meat, milk and eggs and produce when in season. And in Scotland, we're also sort of trying to think about that in a sort of Scottish focus, so 100% Scottish milk, eggs, and you know, sort of quite a high proportion of beef, lamb, and as well. So that sort of competition is very important for consumers. It's our role as retailers to also have that healthy balance to trying to ensure that we are obviously therefore supporting farmers and growers successfully and fairly. Because for us, you know, a successful food service means resilient growing supply base, but also to be very mindful about how we can sort of keep that accessible food for customers as well.
Thank you.
Thank you. Beatrice Wishart.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning. Are there differences in how the food supply chain typically functions for the main agricultural sectors, such as fruit and veg, meat, dairy and cereals? I don't know who wants to kick off with that first.
Simple answer is yes. I suppose we should have said that Sophie and I are in a slightly strange position because we own our own processing facilities, so we own our own vegetable packing houses and fruits, and obviously Morrisons has a greater range than that. The people that supply into that are under the auspices of the code, the groceries code, which would be different for other organisations which might use intermediaries. So we have to, if you like, we're working to a higher level than some of our competition are. That being said, but like Sophie, my milk and dairy products are coming from Arla. I've described our potato supply chain. When it starts to get into some of the commodities, sort of wheat, it obviously becomes much broader, the wider range of markets and the wider range of intermediaries and processes which make the chains more complicated.
Yes, and just to add to that, some of that is obviously seasonally dependent as well. So, you know, we're sort of thinking about the sort of fruit and vegetable sector in particular. You know, sort of from a Morrison's perspective, 65% of our vegetables whilst are UK grown, but the rest are import, but others are imported. However, we are also quite conscious of trying to understand where we can have full all year round supply from the UK and Scotland where possible. For example, 100% of our Swede come from Scotland for the whole of the UK. And we've just moved this year to sort of 100% sort of leeks from Scotland when in season as well. So we're always trying to be very conscious about where we can buy locally and buy from the sort of like buy from the UK or from Scotland. But we are also sort of mindful about what grows here and what doesn't. So you know, obviously that has some effect. But for us, it's an important thing for customers to be able to sort of shop locally.
Okay.
Yep. Jim Fairley.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, and thank you very much for turning up. It's actually very decent to have done so, given the fact that the rest of your competitors aren't here. Can I first of all ask You've both talked about your commitment to Scottish producers, which I absolutely applaud, which is great. There's potential to talk about the branding of Scottish produce, but more importantly, I hear constantly the downward pressure from producers driven by the supermarket power to get them to provide it cheaper, with less security in their contracts and all the rest. But it's a constant supply of information that we get. Do you accept that your commitment to Scottish produce also means that you've got a commitment to the Scottish people to make sure there is a resilient food industry in Scotland? Sophie.
I was going to say, I don't mind going first this time. Yes, absolutely we do. As we were talking about before, you know, it's really important for us to be able to sort of supply those products to our customers, and therefore to know we can only do that. We have a resilient supply base who we can buy from. We really pride ourselves in long-term relationships. And we have many, many farmers who have supplied us for 20-plus years coming into our sort of our depots and into our abattoirs and into our other facilities. We're also sort of very mindful about sort of where we can try and make adjustments and extra support for prices. And it's been incredibly hard. We're farmers at home as well. We absolutely know the pressure that farming has been under these last sort of couple of years and beyond. Our sort of supply as well, therefore, not only is they thinking about the market price, but also where we can go on and do more. We've just been starting for about the past year, a sort of a shared risk initiative in root vegetables and potatoes, where we're underwriting we're only doing that on a small number of farms at the moment to see if it works, but where we're underwriting the cost of any sort of like risk, basically, for any potatoes, so do any costs go down, and if there's a benefit, then we get that shared between the two, to the growers and the Morrisons as
well. That's a really important point, and I'm glad you've brought that up, because from a soft fruit grower's point of view, we've witnessed tunnels lying empty, we've witnessed plants being ripped up and shredded, mulched, because they can no longer make money from them. My understanding is that what we've got is an increase in the shelf price of about 14% last year, or 11% last year, 14% the year before, but the price to the producer has remained static, if not been pushed down. So that shared risk, are you going to put that across all of your sectors?
So we do absolutely listen really carefully, and we have to sort of like have those discussions with all of our suppliers as well, absolutely. But our own margins as well within the supermarkets have been under increasing pressure, and we've also had, for example, in Morrisons, our margins have dropped every year for the last 10 years as we sort of trying to keep paying a fairer price to farmers and other suppliers and growers, but also maintain that sort of price to customers as well. And it is a highly competitive market. You know, we absolutely know that if we put our prices up out of line with other retailers, then customers would choose their feet and walk elsewhere. So we are very conscious about how we can try and keep that balance going between the two, of making sure that we are sort of having future producers there in the future. It's very important to us to make sure we can still source British and Scottish where possible. So it's not in our interest to make sure that that industry isn't there for the future.
Okay, but we've only got one pig processing plant left in the country. We've only got one chicken process plant left in the country. These pressures are going to continue to grow. And if we want to have a resilient industry here in Scotland, the responsibility that you have as a group of organisations is absolutely vital to maintaining that long-term supply chain, and you do accept that.
We absolutely accept that we have to have a fair price that is going to be sort of like having a decent return for everybody so they can continue to invest. It's not the job of supermarkets alone to be able to do that. However, we absolutely know that we want to be able to support futures in the long run. I mean, for pigs, you know, we have our own pig abattoir south of the border anyway, so we are taking sort of pigs south of the border. For chickens, it's interesting. We are, of course, taking from that sort of abattoir, but, you know, there's other things like, for example, Scotland would, we have this feedback often from our egg processors. Scotland would really benefit from its own sort of end of lay hen abattoir as well, because at the moment all of those laying hens, if they're RSPCA assured, have to travel all the way down to Bradford to be processed from Scotland, which does seem unsustainable. So I think there are areas where potentially, you know, it's a question of working together to understand where we can have other sort of elements that can help the supply chain as well.
Okay. Do you want to come in, Chris?
Well, just a quick build, really, which, and sometimes I do farmer meeting and I say, what do you think the number one number that a supermarket looks at when it's trying to work out if it's been successful that day? And usually it's profit or I get something less polite. And I go, well, actually, it's availability. It's were the orders that we put, were they fulfilled by our suppliers? Because if they're not, we end up with spaces on the shelves. And then it doesn't matter about what the quality is, what the branding is, what the flavour is, then it's only a concept to a customer. The customer has to buy a physical product and we have to work as a supply chain to deliver that on the shelf, day in, day out. If we're not doing that right, and that's because there's interruption in the supply chain, and we have lots of conversations, and obviously with the recent energy price spikes, we have a lot more conversations about the fact that we needed to improve cost price to suppliers, otherwise we wouldn't get the supply that we're ordered. And on potatoes, 20% of the cost of a potato can be energy because it's stored. You know, it's keeping those places chilled. So we have to work with suppliers. And I would say we're still quite an attractive proposition. So our local sales within Alistair's stores have gone up by 30%. We're going to list another 240 new Scottish lines next year. And that's great because that shows that, again, as I said to the convener, that shows that the positivity in the industry, in the food industry, which is generating new products which customers want to buy in Scotland.
I would accept you're absolutely, you guys are the place to go and buy our food, but it needs to be on the basis that the guys who are supplying it are getting a fair kick of the ball. Convener, thank you.
Thank you. Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, Convener. Jim Fairley's touched on some of the area I wanted to cover in this section, but I'll ask another question. We've heard that some stakeholders are calling for fruit and veg to be subsidised by the Scottish or UK government. A paper from Warwick University found that this would cost the taxpayers roughly £2.5 billion a year compared to £6 billion a year spent on poor diet-related illness. And I'd be interested to hear what your views are on that. Would supermarkets support government subsidy of fruit and veg?
So I think that would be an interesting concept. I mean, obviously, we're also incredibly mindful of our customer diets, and also we haven't sort of set any targets, for example, for sort of altering the balance of what customers buy. We have actually started a lot of activity, and we're wanting to do even more on encouraging customers to eat more fruit and vegetables, and to be able to eat whole foods as well. We produce some fantastic whole foods, and that be able to sort of know what to do with them when they have them. I mean, fruit and vegetables is maybe a bit more straightforward, but I think to be able to support the subsidy of them, but also to understand, you know, how to be able to eat and prepare them potentially, I think is also going to be important and a good place for government to be able to help as well.
Thanks.
I think the mechanism would need some very careful consideration. How does that going to operate? And I would say that in supermarkets in general actually do push fruit and veg. It's the first area of the store you hit when you come in. When you're thinking about what you're going to buy, you're presented with the fruit and veg in most of the stores. It's the prime selling opportunity. And I would hope that that means that people are then going to make the right type of data choices. But they are individuals.
Thanks. Thanks, Convener.
Kate Forbes.
And once again, I add my thanks to you both for being here. We are obviously scrutinising an agricultural policy bill to replace, essentially, CAP. So very much focused on subsidy, or another word, for that financial support. And so I wanted to go back to how you agree contracts with farmers, cooperatives, wholesalers, and what the process looks like, because Jim has already touched on this point, but the percentage of the profits that actually go back to the producer. So some of the research 2022 food charity Sustained suggested that on 5 everyday items, apples, cheese, beef, burgers, carrots and bread, farmers could sometimes make less than 1% of the profits. Now, that has a direct bearing on where we believe, for example, a subsidy should be set in order to sustain those livelihoods. So can I ask, in terms of that process, how you reach agreement on pricing, how you reach agreement with on volume and timescales? And my little supplementary is I was quite heartened to hear that you have some relationships that go back 25 years, which suggests to me that that is a mutually beneficial relationship. Is that the norm or is that rare?
Okay, so it's sort of set in different ways. So we are very much sort of thinking about a market price when we're sort of setting prices. And market prices, of course, can go up and down. And so our sort of suppliers are ultimately can be free in some cases to choose where they want to go as well. Mm-hmm. So it depends on what they're supplying to which supplier they're supplying with. So, for example, with, you know, dairy contracts tend to be a longer supply agreement with their endpoint. However, actually, some of our suppliers, whilst we've been working with for a really long time through the abattoir, not all of them have a contract that guarantees that they will send their beef or lamb to us, for example. They're free to decide whether they want to sort of like send it somewhere else. However, most of them will continue to be able to sort of send it to us, and we've worked with them for many, many years. So when we're sort of setting that price, I'm very conscious about market pricing, but then we're also thinking about actually, are there any extra areas that we're asking farmers to look at, which we need to be able to therefore add extra payment to, potentially. So, for example, we sort of have initiatives that are looking at additional welfare and sustainability measures in our milk supply chain, where we're paying above the market price for things like that. So that gives additional support for the farmers to be able to go and do more. And similarly, we're sort of quite flexible in how we look at arrangements. If we're doing talking about policy and thinking about sort of like future areas, we're doing an awful lot with farmers looking at as net zero agriculture, sustainable agriculture ways of working. And so we've spent a lot of time, for example, in those cases, investing in farmers having supported carbon footprints or sort of soil carbon testing or other areas as well that will benefit them as a business, but also are not therefore beholden to them to have to pay for. So we're trying to sort of work very much in partnership with our farmers and trying to take things forward and thinking about pricing. When we're thinking about volumes, we're therefore absolutely thinking about what it is that we can sell within obviously the stores themselves, and obviously from a Morrison's perspective, we don't sell just only to Morrison's for our manufacturing business, we also sell to external customers as well, and that includes quite a lot of export too. And so we're sort of therefore mindful about what sort of markets we're selling into and gearing up for additionally. And with that, we'll sort of also work with other organisations like QMS who can help open some of those doors and help sort of facilitate some of those opportunities for us. So it's sort of pricing and volume are absolutely thinking about. You know, we are very conscious about sort of trying to hit that right balance, and it's very difficult. You know, obviously one of the things that was tricky for the pig sector sort of this time last year and going further back was an oversupply of pigs in the market, which is part of the reason, not all of it, part of the reason why the pig price was so sort of depressed. Yeah. You know, we have therefore also took the very hard decision to, through all the sort of like right amounts of sort of notice period for our pig farmers as well, reduce the number of pigs that we had coming into our business, so we could actually sort of just balance the supply a little more and help stabilise the price. So we are very conscious of our role in sort of making sure we're demanding the right numbers to make sure we're not flooding the market with more than is required.
Unhelpfully, it depends.
Yeah, sounds very political.
And supply and demand is huge. So for the big products in Scotland, we're going to use the indices which come out of QMS for beef and lamb and pigs. If you take it slightly broader, so for example, on broilers and eggs, there's a price, but there's also a price, a feed price tracker, which we've operated since April 22, when we started to see the massive volatility in commodity markets. And some organisations, some of the Spanish co-ops, they like to contract for half of the volume, and then they like to see what the spot market does for the other half of the volume. And we're happy to accommodate that. Other areas where there is particularly intense price volatility, you can certainly see in the catching sector at the moment, contracts are agreed on a 3-monthly basis.
One tiny supplementary. Clearly, it's well known, farmers typically make a loss without government subsidy. Can you ever envisage a situation in Scotland where farmers are sufficiently recompensed by the market to not make a loss?
Again, I think that depends. So talk to a lot of farmers, and some will say things in private which they won't say in public. I appreciate there are obviously various farm income studies which show the majority, but I have a range of people doing a range of performance. I would say that there's an awful lot of farmers who produce and then expect it to be sold. And I think going forward, and this was a process that was set in motion back when the McSherry reforms came in 1990, as intervention came out of the CAP, and it was much more market related, much more volatile. People need to be thinking about where they're going to market their product and produce. I think Even the Currie Commission way back when, was that 20 years ago, said that the HM Treasury should be looking at price volatility measures, a bit like the US used insurance to be able to manage this. So I think there are levers if government wants to intervene in marketplaces. Otherwise, you will have supply and demand setting, and we will end up with shrinkage of production. And I think Mr. Fairley rightly pointed out, we'd lose critical mass, and that's when you lose processing and you end up in a bit of a doom loop.
Thank you. Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, Convener. Recently, the Red Tractor Scheme proposed a new environmental assurance scheme, but farmers raised concerns that the new standard would incur higher costs and supermarkets would sell their products at a premium, but farmers would not receive a premium price. And similarly with organics, there is a market premium, but Soil Association and others propose that more of a premium should find its way back to the farmers. And I understand that some supermarkets would pay farmers a higher price, but they feel they can't do that while their competitors keep the price down. So I'd be interested to hear if your companies would welcome regulation in this area so that farmers who produce a premium product to a higher environmental and animal welfare standard would be guaranteed to receive a premium on the price from all of the supermarket buyers.
Yeah, so I don't mind keeping on with that. And also just to sort of like make it sort of transparent that I'm actually the BRC, British Retail Consortium member on the Red Tractor Board as well. So just to sort of make that clear. So with regard to the Red Tractor Greener Farms commitment, that was in proposal of as a voluntary module and not as compulsory one as I'm sure you probably already know. We had said from a Morrison's perspective when that was like being looked at, that yes, of course, we were thinking about how we could try and pay sort of a subsidy towards farmers for doing additional steps towards that environmental module. But that has to be up to each individual retailer, as that hasn't been a price that has been set by Red Tractor. However, what things like the environmental module from Red Tractor do, and other schemes like that, is set consistency. And there's an increasing amount of sort of transparency that's required, and probably absolutely rightly so, in the food supply chain, from which retailers and processors are obliged to report against. And to be able to understand how we can get that data from farms as a primary data source in a consistent package is really, really important. Otherwise, you aren't end up comparing apples with apples. And so schemes like that are very, very helpful. However, it is obviously the benefit again of Red Tractor is that it's and other schemes like it, as it's going across a volume of supply. Organic, for Morrison certainly, will only ever be in relatively small amount of product that is going to be taken in by customers. Our own organic sales are only about 5% of everything that we sell altogether, because our customers tend to be much more value focused. However, for those customers who choose to, then we obviously have organic available and the premiums that are associated with that for the farmers that are producing it as well. But then there are other schemes that we've done ourselves. For example, on our eggs, we've been paying farmers for many, many years to have additional sort of steps towards environment, like additional tree planting and bee cover strips, of which we are asking customers, if they choose to be able to pay a little bit more for those eggs. We have a scheme called For Farmers, where they can choose to pay a little bit extra, and that money goes straight back to the farmers to help them sort of invest in that. So we are trying to make schemes and programmes available for customers to be able to support, so we can pass that money back down to farmers as well.
I think this area of the market is really very dynamic at the present moment in time. Asda is converting all of our produce, both domestic and overseas, over to LEAF, linking environment and farming, which is an integrated farming module. We haven't particularly taken a perspective on the green tractor module at the present moment in time, because integrating the LEAF across is taking a lot of our time. On organics, very similar to Sophie, organic farmers receive a premium. And with that premium goes through to the retail price, and at the present moment in time, organic is in decline.
My kind of question, so it's great to hear that both of you are working in terms of giving farmers that premium price, but do you think that we could get further if there was regulation across the board so everybody had to do it? I mean, just in general, forget about organics, if there was regulation. So I think one of the things I understand is that what you've been talking about this morning is the challenge around the kind of competitive market type margins, and if there was actually regulation in certain situations that could help you all take that step together, do you think that would help us move? I mean, we've got incredible targets, and farming agriculture is plays a big role in that, a climate target we have to reach.
I think your challenge would be, if you did that domestically, how would you regulate imports? And you would end up with potentially a very great differential between the import price, which didn't have to do it, this is a conversation we have all the time, versus domestic producers. You're going to be penalising domestic producers, tying both hands behind their back, and the consumer, who is very time and finance restrained, will make their own rational choice, and it might well end up that you shrink the market for domestic product. Mm,
yeah. I think what we're also what we're also very mindful of is that, you know, we ask consumers a lot, as you would imagine, about, you know, lots of issues to do with sustainability, environment and welfare. And yes, they all want these things to happen, but most of them don't want it to cost them anymore. And so we are sort of quite mindful about how we can try and do both as much as we can. However, allow those sort of schemes and programmes available for those customers who are able to make a bit more of an investment in their food to be able to sort of do so, for example, through Full Farmers or Organic.
I have one very quick build, which is don't forget the caterers. So if you put chicken prices up to £10, but you could go and buy a rotisserie chicken from your local convenience store for £5, that's where you're going to go and buy it, cooked and sorted.
Okay, thanks. Thanks, Convener.
I'm going to keep questions in the same vein and move to Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if you can say a bit more about what you do to work with farmers and others to ensure high standards on environment and animal welfare. You've touched on some of that just now, but specifically on how that's actually scrutinised and reported and assessed by you.
So we have as our core sort of standard for all of our UK sort of production, of which, as I sort of say, we have a British sourcing policy anyway, to go for Red Tractor or QMS, and so that is our baseline standard. And that also enables, you know, to have a standard level of audit and also reporting that we're able to make. On top of that, we have in certain sectors RSPCA Assured, which is particularly for eggs and also for other sort of variants of outdoor bred pork, for example. So many of our vegetable growers are already leaf accredited for other supermarkets, whilst we don't have that ourselves, because they're supplying for multiple other retailers. We, you know, have the benefit of them being able to be that as well. But on top of that too, we're very mindful about trying to understand where we can ask farmers to do more. So I was describing earlier that we have, you know, sort of a various initiatives that we're doing through our Full Farmers range for milk and for eggs, where that money will be directly returned for farmers looking at environmental and animal welfare sort of step-ons in sustainability. But we're also have also set ourselves our own sort of very ambitious ambitions to support agriculture get into a net zero position. And so for that, we've been trying to make very practical steps to sort of bring farmers on the road of carbon footprinting, but more importantly, what to do with that information when they have it, and how to think about an action plan and how that can benefit their business overall. So we're sort of trying to do various different things, from standards to different programmes and ways of working with farmers, to help sort of like encourage them on those next stages of sustainability, which is ultimately what many stakeholders in the food industry, including our customers, are looking for.
So we use Red Tractor as the benchmark standards and require overseas product to be benchmarked against that, with adaptations for local positions. We run farmer groups, the same way that Sophie does, so investing in groups of farmers to look at best practice, to trial things. None of this is about exclusivity, because the field is a very open laboratory and we actually want people to talk. So we've been working with Syngenta and planting 1,000 cover crops on our potato headlands. I would make sort of like a policy direction move, which is they look fantastic. They are beautiful flowers, they look terrific, but they're not there as horticulture, they're not flower beds. So we also pay to have an entomologist go and sample them to see what biodiversity is being generated. So I can give you the breakdown of 150,000 insects. That's what apparently entomologists do in the winter. And what we're now building on that is to say, okay, can we take the labour out of that? Are there laboratory techniques? Are there new opportunities to get this down to a farm level? And so I think pretty well all the retailers are engaged in best practice development and supporting agriculture.
Absolutely.
Thank you. You mentioned some of the things that you do on that front, and clearly farmers, and I'm sure yourselves, are committed to environmental and animal welfare aims. You mentioned some of the interventions there, but of course the big intervention or the big influence you have is the price you are prepared to pay. So how do you ensure that the price you are prepared to pay is having the right influence and not creating perverse incentives, if you like, or creating pressures that are difficult for farmers to reconcile with these high aims?
It's a constant dialogue. We have the potato buyer in Scotland is based in Scotland and is visiting the growers and hearing what's being said. I would say, having been through the price, the energy cost spike in the past 2 years, we proved to be adaptable, all the retailers did, because we were going in front of farmers who were saying, look, if we try and deliver the contract we agreed 3 months ago, I go bust next month. And that doesn't help anybody. So we had to change, and we had to be adaptable, and we had to listen to the concerns of our suppliers. And I would push back and say, look, the shelves are full. I haven't got too many rulings against me from GSCOP. So fingers crossed, touching wood, we're trying to do a good job.
Yeah, absolutely. I think we are equally mindful of making sure that we are paying a fair price to the farmers and sort of like and supporting them in much more holistic sort of aims as well. We also have introduced other things that are trying to sort of support new entrants to farming. So, for example, we've got 1,000 head of cattle on our elite beef scheme in Scotland, which is basically where we're taking beef from the dairy herd, which we prepay for. So we sort of pay for those at the sort of end of rearing. We put those onto farms to contract rear, and then we sort of knock off the price difference when they come into abattoir. And so we're sort of constantly trying to think of different ways to be able to fund growth and development for farms as well, and to be sort of very practical in our approach. It is a real tension trying to understand how to sort of maintain food prices that customers can afford. You know, we have some, as I'm sure you're absolutely aware, some real food poverty in the UK, which is incredibly, you know, sort of sad to see. And we want to be able to try and do our best to make sure that all customers can afford to access healthy and sustainable food. But absolutely, we need to make sure that that is not going to fall over at the other end of the supply chain. And so listening very hard and being able to adapt and sort of change regularly, sort of like the supply payments, is really, really important. So both ends of the spectrum sort of feel that they're listened to.
It may surprise you, we turn down a lot of commercial offers on the grounds that we don't believe it's long-term viable. So someone will come in and offer us a price which has been fed down through their supply chain very often, and we go, we don't think that's going to supply, we think you'll go bust. And then I've got empty shelves, going back to what I said to the committee before, and that's the last thing we want.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Jim Fairley.
Thanks very much, Convener. You have raised some really interesting stuff. I think this has been a brilliant session. So if I want to come back to you, first of all, you talked about the standards, and this is a kind of a follow-on to the last question, but it will lead into my next one. Scottish Quality Beef and Lamb Association, I don't know if you remember it. I have to declare an interest. I used to be a sheep and cattle farmer many years ago. Scottish Quality Beef and Lamb Association was given as an incentive. Join this, we're going to pay you extra. But that incentive became a stick. At what point do you see where we are right now, those incentives that you are encouraging becoming sticks? And I particularly want to talk about carbon credits, because that natural capital that is owned by farmers in their soil is theirs. Is that going to become an incentive at the moment to supply you as part of their ability to be in your supply chain, which then becomes a stick to them later that if they don't give you the value of that carbon credit, that they can no longer supply you?
So we're absolutely aware of the sort of, it's a very sort of burgeoning and emerging industry in carbon credits. And actually, I think what does need guidance and a rule book is about that whole sort of market of carbon markets. It's incredibly, you know, farmers, I go to, as Chris does, huge numbers of farmer meetings where carbon credits are talked about, and no farmer is really understanding what they can do with them, because what are the rules of the game and what's to trust and what isn't to trust. However, for our own perspective, what we've sort of set out from a very early stage is a sort of a progression for farmers to understand how they can make themselves as sustainable as possible and how we can help sort of like reach a net zero position. So we, and that's not at the expense of sort of biodiversity and anything else, it's to do it in a holistic round. So we were very inspired by the NFU's sort of goal of thinking about net zero 2040 or 2035, and wanted to be able to encourage our producers to do the same thing and to sort of go after it. However, we have never sort of said that means that we want the credits that are therefore sitting on your farm. It's about how we can therefore encourage and work with all of the farmers in our supply chain to lower their emissions as low as they can go, and then to raise the opportunities for carbon carbon sequestration, which and carbon holding, which also have a very good biodiversity impact on the farms as high as they can go, so they get to a net zero position. Now, that is also not saying that if you're not at that point, you're out and you're not allowed to come into a Morrison supply chain, but we know that our customers are looking for sustainable food, but we also know that as a retailer, we have a huge amount of pressure put on us by certain sort of NGOs and groups to sort of adopt a meat reduction target, which we don't think is, for us, the right thing to do. For us, it's much more about how can we make meat more sustainable, how can we make meat, which is a really excellent protein source for customers, accessible, sustainable, and something that customers don't have to feel guilted into not buying, which is some of the narrative that does come through. And so for us, it's about actually absolutely supporting those farmers to be robust and resilient in the future. Not everything, but many, many ways of lowering emissions are also about lowering costs and being more efficient. How can we sort of like help support farmers get there through the right skills and knowledge and tools to do the job? But absolutely, you know, we're not there to do a dawn raid on carbon credits. We're there sort of thinking about how they can really, you know, help improve their own farm situation and hopefully improve soil capacity for the future as well.
Chris?
You've only got 20 minutes, so let me have a quick go at this one.
A very quick go. Yeah. My apologies.
I'd not touch it with the dodgiest of barge poles. A couple of reasons why. One, at the moment, DEFRA has a group, which the Scottish Government is an observer on food data transparency. One of the work streams is looking at the whole area of eco-measurement. Last time I looked, I think it had 4 pages of questions. I do not understand for the life of me how we can set government policy on something as important as food production for this nation when we don't actually understand the question we're posing ourselves. I think the whole area of how people look at carbon labelling and the rest of it has run way ahead of the science. I don't think we have, for example, a true handle on carbon cycling. We're going through the process because it's what we have to do. But when I talk to them and say, OK, if I put biscuit waste into an AD plant, that's zero carbon. I put biscuit waste into a cow, which also produces methane, and all of a sudden it's got all the carbon costs associated with it. Are you going to correct for that? Or we'll get back to you. I say, well, how are we going to declare this? I'm going to put a carbon label on so that the public can make a choice when they go into the shop. So let's do that and put it on a kilo of cabbage and a kilo of beef. A kilo of cabbage is 90% water. A kilo of beef is only 30%. You're going to correct for that? Do you want to correct for the nutrition that's in a kilo of beef in terms of amino acids and proteins which we need, or just the bit of vitamin C that's in a cabbage? I think the questions are so big and they have been ducked, and we need to generally get a hold of all this. As Sophie said, it's a bit like the Wild West, but point out Clint Eastwood came into the Wild West and shot the bad guys. At the moment, the bad guys are running the school.
Right, OK, that is really interesting. We're going to have you guys back again.
I'm afraid we're going to have to move on. We've only got 15 minutes left and we've still got quite a few questions to get through. I'm going to move on to a question from Rachel Hamilton.
Good morning and thank you for being here. Does the contractual process vary between different agricultural sectors? Shall I start with you, Chris?
Yes.
Yep.
So, as I think I've described, some of the Spanish growing cooperatives contract half of their volume and then spot market the other half of their volume. Bananas are on an annual basis with a cost adjustment for logistic costs and currency changes, so people can fit into that. When it comes to beef and lamb and pork, they're against the QMS market standards. I'm trying to think, as I said, there's a feed tracker on broilers and on egg layers. And generally, we'll shift the contracts or the arrangements depending on what people want. You know, we've been taking beef from ABP since 65. Campbell's, Glenrath Eggs has been supplying us 25 years plus. I've been told off by John Campbell so many times. So you just sort of have to, these are part of a dialogue. It's not, the conversations are done face to face or Zoom to Zoom, but they're part of a conversation around supply and demand and the pressures which people are facing.
Yeah, I mean, I was looking at some of the stats and I was concerned to see that one in five farmers say they've suffered because a wasted crop because of cancelled orders. 29% of those farmers had no explanation, and 29% had not been paid in 30 days. And I think some of the key areas that where farmers are concerned is that they want to sell what they agreed to sell to supermarkets. They want to be paid what was agreed to be paid. They want to be paid on time. They want to a longer-term commitment rather than short-term for the sustainability, and they want to agree on fair specifications. But it sounds as though Chris is saying that the supply and demand, the affordability, other external factors are playing into this. So how can supermarkets, with a really challenging legislative demand on the agricultural bill for Scotland's farmers, how can they look to a sustainable future, I suppose, and ensure that perhaps somebody can succeed them in their farm?
So when we're sort of thinking about a few of those points in your question, so payment terms, for example, when we're working with farmers and as with other small suppliers, which include local food makers into Scotland, we've got a policy where we pay within 7 days. So that sort of automatically helps the farmer's sort of cash flow position. Because we're very mindful about sort of paying more quickly. With contracts as well, you know, as Chris was describing before, yes, there's sort of market elements, but then also we recognise that for sort of producers to be able to invest some more longer-term contracts. So, for example, we've just moved to even up to 7 years contracts for some of our egg suppliers in the UK. We have also sort of extended to two-year contracts for potatoes instead of annual sort of negotiations. The annual negotiations do, however, leave everybody free to move. So, you know, and other people can, and so we're not sort of tying in for forever, but we also are very open to listening and therefore not just having a one-size-fits-all approach to all farmers and all suppliers, trying to be really, really responsive in how we sort of setting contracts, how we're setting prices, and how we're setting those payment terms, particularly for small family businesses, of which farming is one, which they need to understand how to be able to get, as I say, those payments across, which we think short payment terms is a really sensible way to go forward.
Yeah, I mean, obviously the dairy industry is to be legislated, well, is to be protected, I suppose, let me use that term broadly, and so that dairy farmers are able to stop any contract changes, have a fair say in the process. And I just wondered, you know, that I suppose we're hoping that that's going to be quite groundbreaking for dairy farmers. Do other sectors in agriculture have the same ability to cancel a contract or come to you and say, look, you know, there's been a frost, we've had a drought, there's been flooding, you know, we've got issues here, you know, can you be flexible? Chris?
We have to be. I would just say, just to cover off on dairy, we're both supplied by Arla, which is a farmer cooperative, so it doesn't get covered by that piece of guidance. I would also say that one of the things which has never happened in the UK, which has happened overseas and was always available under the EU regulations, was the ability to form a producer organisation, which takes you out of competition law. So some of the remedies were in the farmers' hands if they could get together and agree anything.
Okay. Sophie, can I pick you up on something that you said earlier in terms of you... I can't quite remember your words, but you almost said that you would honour a contract. I'm trying to get at the eventuality of flooding. So recently there was Storm Babette, and I know that many farmers lost their potato crops, and others lost, I can't remember what it was.
Neeps,
I think there were neeps, yeah. What I'm interested to know is, do farmers have to go out onto the open market to honour the contract? I'm not sure if it's necessarily relevant in your case, Sophie, because you're sort of controlling that within your growers. But I'm not elsewhere. Chris, could you support somebody who was in a situation where they had to go on the open market and buy potatoes to supply to you or buy neeps to supply to you?
Yeah, I was in a departures lounge on the continent and my brassica supplier wandered in and I thought, what the heck are you doing here? So I've just had a thunderstorm in the UK. This was a high summer and the hailstorms has come and the hailstones have just bruised my spinach crop. I need to go and find some spinach and here I am trying to find it. there are people who sort of take an opportunity as well and look and see whether or not they could win. So there are French growers of parsnips, which the French don't consider worth feeding to cattle, but they have it just in case there's a bad dose of weather in the UK and they can send parsnips in. So back to that dynamic in the industry, people. But yeah, if people have got problems, then we have conversations. You know, and we talked about the stewards at ASI. We're a very big customer of theirs. We have big conversations with them. Mm. I think one of the things which is happening, and again from a policy perspective, giving capital opportunities so that people can give themselves more their own personal protection. So we've got increasingly leaf salads, which aren't grown in greenhouses, but have roofing on. Now, that's not to protect them from snow, it's to protect them from excess rainfall, which causes soil contamination of the leaves from splatter, which then makes them useless for being put into bag salad. So people are making those rational decisions. I think there's a longer-term view needed about security of food, which could encompass maybe some capital assistance to do that type of thing.
OK, one quick last question.
I'm afraid we're way behind schedule. Sorry. I'm going to move to a question from Karen Adam.
Thank you, convener. I think we've had quite a full, rounded discussion on a few of the points I would have liked to have raised. But if you don't mind, I will go back to a few. And I think since my time here on the Rural Committee, we first scrutinised the Good Food Nation Act. We now scrutinise this future agricultural bill. And throughout all of that, talking and discussing with witnesses that have came to committee, and then going out and actually talking to industry leaders, farmers, tenant farmers, and constituents who are in areas of deprivation, there is obviously a move of a spotlight onto the markets when industry, farmers, for example, food producers are telling us that they don't feel that they're getting a good price, that perhaps sometimes their eyes move to the consumer, but then the consumer is telling us, we can't afford this food. So it always comes back to this conversation of, well, you know, what is happening with the supermarkets. So I'd just like to give you, you know, this opportunity to be able to speak to that and, you know, tell us what factors you would consider in setting these supermarket prices, and do you appreciate that there is that discussion there with how you operate?
Yeah, absolutely we do. I mean, you know, we're sort of, as we've been describing, you know, listen really carefully to customers, and we know that customers are feeling incredibly stressed, and also that's regionally dependent. You know, we do a sort of like a customer survey, and it shows that customers in Scotland, for example, are 18 points more sensitive and more worried about money than they are in London. So we're very mindful about, you know, how customers are feeling, and absolutely we're very mindful about how farmers are feeling. As we were describing, you know, we buy directly from about 2,500 farmers altogether across the UK, but 900 in Scotland, you know, and they make it, you know, it's really tough, and the cost of production has really been a very big challenge for farmers, particularly in feed, fertiliser and fuels. Now, we have sort of obviously seen the step back on energy prices, but we have been very mindful about how we can absorb some of those costs, which is partly why the costs of Morrison's went up a little sooner than they did at other retailers at the beginning of the cost of production crisis, because having manufacturing, we sort of like drew that straight into our chain. However, as the cost of sort of started to ease slightly, we've been able to pass some of those costs on to consumers. But obviously within the middle, we have our own huge, enormous cost set of challenges have happened as well. So, you know, quite rightly thinking about colleague pay and colleague wages, but also our own energy bills as well, you know, and our own rates and other areas as well have gone up astronomically as a business. And so it is absolutely a balancing act, and we're very, very mindful of how we're sort of playing our part responsibly within that. And sort of as we just described before, it's an extremely competitive business. You know, supermarkets, we're only talking between 2% and 4% margins altogether from a supermarket perspective. And so, you know, it's a very, very sort of like careful tightrope that we're balancing to try and have the cost of food right, thinking about our own costs of running the business centrally and making that as efficient as we possibly can do, and then also thinking about how we're making sure that we still have farmers and growers there in the future to be able to buy from.
Yeah, no, we see it too. All right, just a quick stat that we have our income tracker, which looks at our customers. I think the stat that jumped out at me last year was 50% said they weren't going to go on holiday. They were basically going to do day trips during the summer. So there's an awful... We recognise those pressures. The other thing I would say is that, don't forget, there tends to be a bit of a lag because of those contracts and everything else, so that you wouldn't see the cattle price dropping tomorrow, you're not going to see the price of beef dropping the day after. You know, these things have got those buffers within supply and being drawn down. Sorry, Convener.
Thank you. Rhoda Grant.
Thank you. You've both spoken about how you source from Scotland, but I wonder what the constraints are on sourcing locally. So what do you take into account when you're deciding between whether you source in Scotland, the UK, internationally?
We source from Scotland. I think one of the constraints is availability of processing. So like Sophie, we're taking pigs out of Scotland. They're being processed in England to come back into Scotland. And similarly, we will take a couple of thousand lambs a month out of the borders to go to our Dunbeer plant in Preston in Lancashire to fulfil. Now, there's a reality check here as well. In Scotland is, what, 500% self-sufficient in lamb. So there's a question mark about whether or not the investment is in production of sheep or production of lamb. But I think one of the constraints very definitely is processing, ever since Broxburn went on pigs.
I think just being mindful of time, another sort of area we're looking at as we work very closely with QMS and also the Scotch PGI, but you know, one of the things we can't do is assign a Scotch beef status to cows. So, you know, sort of cow, so female, obviously coming into the beef supply chain, perfectly good to eat, you know, actually being sold as a premium in France, you know, for being particularly aged, but they're not available to be sort of like named through the Scotch beef standard. It can only be males. So that's one of those sort of constraints, for example, which would be a practical change, which would enable us to be able to have more beef to sell in Scotland.
That's maybe something that we as a committee need to look at. It seems very strange to me. Can I just ask him the question about processing and the ability to process? I was told about a supermarket, not yourselves, I hasten to add, that was sourcing local potatoes, but that they were going to England for washing and packaging to come back to the local supermarket. And everyone thought it was coming 5 miles down the road rather than doing huge miles in the processing. Is there a way we can overcome that? Is that common practice? What can we do?
We pack our potatoes in Scotland.
Yeah, we don't. We don't now. We do pack our potatoes south of the border, and we do pack our potatoes in Gabbrook in Cheshire, so, and then bring them back up to Scotland. So, yeah, so there is that challenge for us as well. So being able to have sort of more processing facilities available and packing facilities is good. The reason we did that was about economies of scale. So we just needed to, and also how the way you make a manufacturing business play pay is to make sure that each of those sites are as efficient as possible and running almost as full as they can be. So we had to sort of take the very hard decision about coming out of Scotland and moving our sort of potato into sort of two sites in England instead. So sometimes those economies of scale have just meant that we couldn't keep the site open in Scotland.
Okay, thank you.
Just very briefly, what priority do you put on margins when you look at whether to procure pork or pig products or beef products when you've got a choice? So if you touched on an overproduction of pig meat, but I presume that means you didn't just stop procuring from overseas, and that would be the same situation when you look at beef, because I understand that Morrisons have interest in farms producing beef out with the UK. So what priority is margin when it comes to looking at limitations from sourcing more locally?
We're, for beef, for all of our fresh meat, we're 100% British, so we don't have any farms outside the UK that we buy from. And similarly for pork, we sort of are taking from sort of six farms in Scotland, and that volume has remained consistent. However, we are sort of absolutely set by a global price when it comes to pork, and the sort of market sort of the fluctuations both of African swine fever, but also China's shutdown of imports had a huge effect on the pig price as well.
Okay, thank you. Chris, have you any comments?
Just a very quick one, which is as the committee is looking at policy, the fact that we're still measuring beef carcasses on the Europe grid, which was designed for beef intervention purchases, is nuts. We need a much better decision. That would help everyone in the supply chain.
When in line to quality.
That leads us, hopefully, into a question from Jim Fairley about the production size and whatever.
Are we going into that? Is that question 7? Right, okay. Sorry, we're jumping about all over the place here. You guys have just made this too interesting. The role of supermarkets, what do you play in determining specification for certain products, like cuts of meat, size or shape of fruit and veg? And as a former sheep producer, I know that you wanted them at 21 kilos so you could get your chop sizes that size so they fitted in a packet and they reached a price point. However, nature doesn't work like that. So can that system lead to massive food waste, which is, if you account it as a country, it'd be the third largest emitter in the world?
So yeah, absolutely. So that's a lot to do in 30 seconds. So, we are very mindful about, you know, what, of course, practically is going to be not only just fitting in the pack, but also what consumers want to eat and what they want to go for. And also, you know, what sort of fat content that has as well. And therefore, additionally, what waste we're sort of having to cut off at butchery and the additional sort of like efficiency demands that would have if the cattle are coming with that are just too fat or and needing too much there for extra processing. And so, yes, I mean, with sheep in particular, obviously, there are so many different breeds to go for. However, we are sort of like looking towards a certain sort of like, we've got a bit of tolerance, we're not sort of quite so sort of fixed, but we have got a certain pack size that we are needing to sort of be able to sort of satisfy. For things like vegetables though, for example, we have a policy the same as we do for fish and buying the whole crop. And so we buy the whole crop from the field and then through our processing facilities, we sort of have one key, we have, you know, products that go to animal feed where they really can't go anywhere else, as well as obviously into sort of premium class one and class two. So we are trying to do the whole piece that we can with that sort of field.
So from a fruit and veg point of view, there is no penalty to the farmer for producing odd-shaped carrots or odd-shaped...
Absolutely, no.
That used to be the case.
It did used to be the case. And I remember, I think I was at Asda about 20 years ago, and that was like the case. But it was... But absolutely, we sort of like taking him, because the wonky market is actually incredibly well-liked by supermarket customers. Yeah. Sometimes we can't... Sometimes they want to buy more wonky than they do core. Right. So it's something that customers are quite bothered.
Chris, very quickly, I'm going to ask you this. You talked about Scotland's 500% self-sufficient in lamb, and yet we still import it from New Zealand. Is that because of size packaging? Is it because of price? Why is it?
It's because of a spike in demand for legs in Easter and Christmas.
Mm. So you can't get rid of the rest of the carcass, therefore you'll buy New Zealand lamb leg.
Yeah, and don't forget 25% of UK lamb is currently being exported. Mm-hmm. And we don't talk about that. It's not a supermarket market anymore. These are other markets, and I think there's a big information piece which still needs to happen to the farming community about where their animals are going and what those markets are requiring.
Yeah, but it just seems kind of counterintuitive that we're 500% self-sufficient in lamb, but you still go to New Zealand. Supermarkets still go to New Zealand. Sorry, that was...
But it's the outer balance requirement, and people... And a shift in preference. Customers like leg meat. Mm. You know, shifting shoulders, whole shoulders, is tricky. You do need to be quite an interest in anatomy.
We've run out of time, but there is one topic that I would like you to briefly touch on, and we may write to you for further clarification. Rachel Hamilton's got a question on the grocer's
Has the introduction of the grocery code adjudicator benefited anyone in the supply chain, food supply chain? In what way?
There is a route through for complaints to happen. It's got statutory powers. Buyers in Asda, and I'm sure in Morrison's too, all have to be trained. And so the fact that there is a complaints procedure which is there in law with an independent adjudicator is an incredibly strong message both to farmers and also, I guess, to customers as well, the operations of the supply chain.
Yeah, we similarly, you know, because we're buying directly from so many farmers, the farmers are also covered by the groceries code adjudicator, not just the suppliers. So that makes a very big difference. We also have a director who's solely responsible for taking on those complaints independently within Morrison's. And so actually, the farmers or any supplier doesn't feel that they don't have a route, they can only speak to their buyer or trading director, they can go and speak independently to somebody who's solely responsible for, well, part, which is other things in audit, but is absolutely responsible for making sure that code is listened to and that farmers and suppliers being listened to
just
as well.
Just out of interest, how many appeals have there been?
How many what, sorry?
Appeals have there been or complaints? Complaints?
I don't know. I would have to come back to you on that.
We also have a compliance officer as well. I think all the retailers do, who are covered by the code.
Just on that, Chris, you touched on earlier that not everybody came under the groceries, but you felt you did because you process a lot of the...
Morrison's, because we've taken
absolutely.
We do the process, so therefore we're buying from growers. It means that a grower can then comes under the auspices and can make a complaint. That wouldn't be true if they're selling to an agent, to a pack house, to a retailer.
So in your opinion, do you believe that the groceries code should... be expanded to include everybody in that supply chain?
No.
Why?
Because I think you open a real door to you immense complexity. If it goes to the first point in the chain, I think we can manage that. Once you go further down, so for example, a sheep farmer that's putting lambs into St Boswell doesn't know where those lambs are going. It doesn't like the price, but they're going to make a complaint. Do they know where their lambs are going? I think that becomes very difficult to manage, and also to resource. Don't forget this costs, and being able to... don't forget the grocery code checks on the contract being delivered. It doesn't talk about price.
Okay. Jim, very, very briefly.
Yeah, I'm going to disagree with you on that one, Chris, and I think we should be having a further conversation about the whole supply chain being included in the grocery code adjudicator on the basis that where does the primary producer go to when they have this feeling that they are being completely shafted, pardon my French, that's the word that would be used, by the supermarkets. Surely it's in the benefit of the supermarket industry to have that ability to say at any point in any stage in this supply chain, you've got someone that you can speak to and that can hold us account if we are doing something wrong. Surely that's a good thing.
I could do that on a grower, but you need to have something stronger than a feeling, Jim. And I do think that for some sectors that would be very difficult because they're assembly processes and they don't know where they... it would be very difficult to work out exactly what's happened in terms of attribution of value.
Mm. OK, I think that's going to be a great session. Could we get them back, please?
Sophie, did you have anything to add to that?
No, just I think, as I've already said, we're sort of slightly different because we have so much of our farmers that are already covered by the Groceries Code Adjudicator. I suppose it makes us think about it, therefore, slightly differently. And I also think, I spend a lot of time, as I'm sure my colleagues do as well, going around to farmers' meetings, because I think it's really important that there is that transparent dialogue and that farmers know that they have somebody to talk to even to understand how things work, because actually we do quite a lot of days, for example, where we bring farmers around abattoirs and supply chain and they go, oh, crikey, I didn't know all of this went on after it left my farm. And so actually that sort of increasing transparency about what happens to the product as an education piece of farmers is as important as thinking about the discussion about price.
Thank you very much. I really appreciate that you've come to represent Morrisons and Asda's today where others have failed to. I hope you believe that after this session that we don't bite. And when we're here to bring that clarity and transparency to the food chain, we really appreciate your involvement in this. No doubt we'll be in touch again. We might have some written questions we'd like to follow up on. So thank you very much once again. We'll now suspend this meeting until 10:15.
Welcome back. We now have our first of two roundtables this morning on the Scottish Government's proposed Stage 2 amendments to the Wildlife Management and Muirburn Scotland Bill. This session will focus on the proposed ban on the use of snares in Scotland. We have a tight 1 hour to get through the questions. So rather than allow you to introduce yourselves, I'm just going to go around the table. Starting with Jessica Finlay from Nature Scot. We have Glenn Evans from BASC, Libby Anderson from the SAWC, Ross Ewing from SLE, Penny Middleton from NFUS, Connor Kelly from the Scottish Gamekeepers Association, Bob Elliott from OneKind, Ross McLeod from the Game and Wildlife Conservation Trust, and Chief Superintendent Mike Flynn from the Scottish SPCA. As I say, there's a lot of people in the session today, and we've only got an hour, so can I ask you to keep your contributions short and only indicate to come in when you've got something further to add to the question. We're going to take one question, and at the end, hopefully, we'll have some time for some supplementary questions from members. And if you could raise your hand, I'll try and bring you in turn to address the question that's been asked. So the first question I'll kick off. I can ask what you believe the animal welfare impacts of snaring in Scotland are, and do you agree with the Scottish Government's proposal to implement a full ban on the use of snares? And is there any arguments for any exemptions? And I'll kick off with, on my right, probably someplace with Jessica.
Okay, thank you very much. So in terms of the information that Nature Scot holds, we don't have a specific remit associated with snaring. We are aware that snaring does have the potential to cause potential welfare issues for target and non-target species. But in terms of the predator control, you know, we recognise that there's a breadth of predator control measures that are undertaken, that they can have sort of positive impacts, but that's quite complex in and of itself in terms of predator impacts are quite difficult to disentangle, but in terms of the precise information around snaring, that's something that we don't hold because we don't have a particular remit associated with that.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to bring in Libby Anderson because Libby here's to represent the Scottish Animal Welfare Commission who reported back on this. Libby, would you like to make some comments?
Yes, thank you, Convener. The Commission does support the proposed amendment. In our advice to ministers, we highlighted that any live trap has an impact on the welfare of the animal that's captured. So while we're aware that have been modifications to snare design, the basic principle of the snare is one that continues to cause suffering to the animals that are captured in it, and there is a risk of asphyxiation, strangulation, evisceration. All of these have been documented well over the many years that I've been aware of snare use. As I say, I'm sure we'll come on to modifications that are current at the moment. I'll leave those aside for the moment. But the principle of capturing an animal by a wire noose around the neck and leaving it for up to 24 hours exposes it to significant welfare harms. And very briefly, we don't think there should be any exemptions to this ban.
OK, thank you. I'm going to bring in Ross Ewing and then Glenn Evans.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning, everybody. I think, first of all, the thing I just wanted to highlight is some findings of the review of snaring for the Scottish Government, which took place in February 2022. For those that are unaware of this, basically, under the Wildlife and Natural Environment Act that was passed, there was a review of snaring that took place every 5 years. And in the latest review, which was in 2022, it did give us some insights, I suppose, as to the scale of snare misuse in Scotland, which I think perhaps might be quite instructive in this regard, especially when talking about those potential negative implications. So, the total number of standard prosecution reports received by the Crown Office Procurator Fiscal between 2012 and 2016 was 23, and between 2017 and 2021 was 18, so there has been a reduction there. And the other thing that I just wanted to highlight, Convener, because I think it really is an important point, and it was touched on by the Minister last week, but the review was very clear about where it felt the issue was with regard to illegal snare use and, by extension, those welfare implications. And it said, and I quote, "The review group consider that it would be very difficult difficult to legislate for the actions of individuals where the modus operandi is to undertake an act of snaring with the intention of committing an associated crime. So, and they go on to say that the cases prosecuted tend to point to deliberate abuse for purposes ranging from poaching to badger persecution. To be clear, that is completely distinct from illegal snare operators and what they do, and I'm sure the practitioners in the room will have more to add about how they go about safeguarding animal welfare when utilising these devices, Convener.
Thank you. I'm going to bring in Glenn Evans, but I'm aware, Glenn, that Basque also played quite a role in the recent legislation in the Welsh Assembly. Could you maybe touch on that in your contribution?
Yes, so I'm actually somebody who lives in Wales, so who will be impacted by the decision to ban snares in Wales. And the legislation in Wales bans all snares, including licence. It closes the licensing route as well. I think this is going to be an absolute disaster. I can give an example. We don't have many grouse moors in Wales, but there is one grouse moor, and they use humane cable restraints. They hold 85% of the black grouse population in Wales. So when we look at rare species, curlews, lapwings, I genuinely think we will rue the day in Wales that they've been banned now. I just wanted to touch on something that Libby mentioned about asphyxiation. Modern design snares, humane cable restraints, have stops, and the stop is specifically selected to be there at 26 centimetres. So it will not close beyond that point. So it will not asphyxiate a fox that is caught in it. It cannot happen. The stop prevents that.
OK, thank you. And your experience in the legislation in Wales?
So we presented evidence. There are different committees in Wales. One of the committees in 2017 suggested we had a voluntary code of practice, which the Welsh Government drew up. And the suggestion with that committee was almost a stepwise approach. So if things were not shown to have proven, and it's very hard to prove a negative, that we would take a stepwise approach similar to what has happened in Scotland with training and registration. However, the Welsh Government moved forward and decided to introduce a ban.
OK, thank you. I'll move on to a question from Jim Fairley.
OK. Scottish Land Estates have proposed a licensing scheme which should be introduced, enabling certain snares to continue to be used. We're talking about the cable restraints that you just talked about there, Glenn, under specific licence for specified purposes, including preventing harm to wildlife, game birds, livestock and crops.
Mike, what is your view on that?
Scottish SPC, you'll be unsurprised to know, follows the government's stated intention of banning all types of devices, snares. You can rebrand them as you like, but from what I see with the humane cable restraint, to all intents and purposes, is a snare. So we would agree with an entire ban.
Connor, what's your response to that?
I don't know if you have much experience of humane cable restraints and the use of them. However, we changed in our management style about 2 years ago to humane cable restraints. And my experience, being a practitioner, is that our non-target catches went down significantly. We rely on them, on humane cable restraints, massively, as the estate that I'm on is currently what you would classify as an island, with no predator control being carried out in the surrounding areas. So, to give you a scale of things, we control about 200 foxes a year on the land, and 61% of that is through humane cable restraints. So, the removal of this tool would be absolutely detrimental to what the practice goes on the estate. People say, oh, well, it's the same. And I get how, perception is that it's a cable and it's a wire. However, you've got a breakaway device now on it. So we found that, again, with some deer and badgers as well, that they've managed to break free. And we record that. It goes on to a database shared with the GWCT. So that is recorded. And then you've, as Glenn pointed out, you've a 26-centimetre stop, which stops the asphyxiation of any fox. We are finding with them that foxes are managing to get out of them. So it's of the most importance that we are there. We try to be there no later than 1 hour after daylight. I know some people will point out, well, it's every 24 hours. However, we tend to find best practice we're there as early as we can. So to stop any kind of longevity of a fox being in the device. So that's my experience.
Thank you. I'm going to bring in Ross McLeod from the Game Wildlife Conservation Trust.
Thank you, Convener. The GWCT has been working on research into predator control for the best part of 40 years now. We've been researching fox movement as well, and for that purpose we've used humane cable restraints to catch foxes, to tag them and release them. And in our experience in those situations, we've actually re-caught some foxes and been able to assess their welfare, and they've looked absolutely fine under those circumstances. We also listened to the Minister's words very carefully in the evidence session last week, and she rightly concentrated on welfare. I think the aspect we were most concerned about is that there wasn't a mention from the Environment Minister, about the impacts on rare, iconic and vulnerable species like curlew, lapwing, oyster catcher, black grouse, capercaillie, and this list goes on. And for that purpose, that's the reason why we think a conservation licence type approach will be a sensible provision, particularly now because we can monitor, as was indicated by Connor, we can monitor through mobile app recording exactly what's happening. And there's every reason to think we can improve the technology further in that regard to give early warning of when foxes are in snares.
Ross Ewing.
And just to follow on from what Ross was saying there, and we've actually done a survey ahead of this evidence session taking place where we basically surveyed 129 land managers in conjunction with Scotland's regional moorland groups. Off those 129 responses, 98% of them said that there would be a negative impact on biodiversity if this goes through. These are the experts, the people that work on the land and know best ultimately what would happen. And indeed, if you actually look at that further and try and understand the implications on job losses, we asked them if snares and cable restraints were to be banned, and do you think it would result in job losses? 72% of those that we surveyed said yes. So that is just to highlight the extent and scale of what we're talking about here. And last week we were really struck because we didn't think that the Minister was able to really articulate the scale and extent of snare use in Scotland, which are now being largely superseded by HCRs, I'm pleased to say. 61% of foxes in Scotland, broadly we think, are controlled using lamping or thermal, and 39% are controlled using snaring. 0%, to our knowledge, are controlled using live capture traps. And it's for all those reasons, Convener, that we think that the licensing scheme that we and alongside others have devised constitutes a compromise approach that would ultimately enable cable restraints, humane cable restraints, to continue to be used under licence. And the licensing scheme is predicated on the land, and that's really important because it is the characteristics of the land, be it topography, be it cover, be it windblow, that necessitates snare or HCR use. And that's a really important point to note. And we have included things in the draft licensing scheme, such as, you know, you need to make sure that Nature Scots would have to be satisfied that no other method of fox control is reasonably practical on the land. So we are talking here about broadly, it needs to really be the last resort, but there are some places where it is absolutely instrumental, and we cannot get away from that point, Convener.
Can I just ask, have you any indication of how many old-type snares are currently being used as opposed to the new humane constraint devices?
We've been kind of alongside the Game and Wildlife Conservation Trust and the Scottish Gamekeepers Association really been pushing the use of the humane cable restraints. It's not widespread at this point, and that's because the current code compliant snare in Scotland necessitates the type of snare completely different from a HCR. So it's only been trialled by a handful of states, including Connor's state there as well. But I think the important point to note is that at the moment Scotland's code of practice it basically has got a snare within it that is not a HCR, despite what you've been told by certain people, Convener. It is distinct, and we can evidence that and show you that quite clearly.
Okay, I'm going to bring in Penny Middleton, then back to Glenn Evans.
I wanted to go back to your original question of the animal welfare impacts of snaring and arguments for exemption. I spent previous 10 years of my life as an SSPCA inspector, and I fully understand exactly where the committee's coming from. The types of injuries I saw through snare use were absolutely horrific, and completely understand why people have such bad connotations with snares. I do, however, believe that the most recent changes in 2011 did really concentrate and improve the use of snares significantly, that would address a lot of the problems that were previously seen. And I think this new humane cable restraint device will take that even further. If you then parcel that up with use being under licence, I think you have got a very, very different situation for what most people will think about when they think about snaring. And obviously from the farmer's point of view, pest control is a necessary activity on farm. We speak to farms that lose sheep on a regular basis over lambs, rather, on a regular basis through foxes, and they know that once a fox finds them, it can come night after night after night. And snares sometimes in that situation really are the only option available. This can either be due to the topography and the type of land, as Ross says, some areas that's what it is, but also that time restraint and lack of skills that we've moved on a long way in farming, and farmers have lost a lot of the skills involved with lamping and shooting of foxes, so it does become really the only option for them.
Jim, a very brief on this specific point.
Yeah, it's on the specific penny. You just said something there where everybody accepts the fact that we need to control foxes. I'd like to ask Bob, Mike and Libby, do you agree that there is a need to control foxes? Bob.
Thanks, Jim. Obviously, in certain circumstances, it might be the case, but what we're talking about here is snares. So we're talking about snares being indiscriminate.
Yes, but if we accept the fact that there is a need to control them, do you accept the fact that there is, in certain circumstances, a need to control the numbers?
Not using these devices, no.
OK. Mike?
Yeah, I totally agree with farmer. It's funny, just looking at our statistics, we have got no record of a farmer being involved in illegal snaring at all. Whatsoever, and I agree that farmers have got to be able to protect their livestock.
Yeah, do you accept the fact that there is, as Penny says, there is a need to be able to control foxes in certain circumstances? Do you agree with that principle?
In a humane manner, yes.
Yes, Libby.
Yes, we've not been asked to opine on the need or otherwise for controlling foxes, which is why you're asking, but I also would be aware that in terms of lamb mortality, that is a very multifactorial issue, and the statistics on fox predation on lambs indicate that it's actually a very low strand of the problems that affect lambs. And I know this has been discussed in the committee before, and the Commission wrote to the convener and to the members of the committee pointing out the Scottish Government research on lamb predation.
So you would just say no, there is no need?
I would not say no, there is no need, but I think that need needs to be evaluated. I think another thing the committee has heard of previously is the international consensus principles for wildlife control, and any wildlife control technique should be evaluated in the light of those principles, and that includes whether it's necessary, whether it can be affected by changes in human behaviour or practices. So you may feel we're not giving a straight answer, but that's because it's a very complicated question.
OK, thank you, Camille.
I'm going to bring in Glyn Evans.
Yeah, so there are lots of points there, but I'll just touch on one to keep it succinct. At times, there are a need to control foxes, and at times, humane cable restraints, modern snares, and we need to understand there is a complete difference between an old-fashioned snare, self-locking snares have been illegal for over 40 years, and modern humane cable restraints. And when we talk about international agreements, these devices meet international standards for restraining traps. The modern devices meet that. And just to touch very briefly on a point that Ross made, times of the year, the cover will be too high. So I will go, I control foxes. My preferred option generally is to use a rifle, but at times of the year, the cover will be too high where I live. I cannot see a fox to shoot it. I need to use a different method. In the past, that would have been humane cable restraints. And it's really important to understand that the time of the year when it's difficult to control foxes with a rifle because the cover's high is also the time of most conservation need when you have ground nesting birds on the ground. If you don't have a method, they are going to suffer.
Yeah, bring in Ross Young and then Bob Elliott.
Convener, the context here is really, really important. The first point to note is that we are in a biodiversity crisis and those reasons have been set out very clearly by the GWCT. I'm not going to repeat those. The other point to note is that already we have lost one third, if you like, of the toolkit for fox control through the Hunting with Dogs Act that passed earlier this year. Now, I know there's a licensing scheme in place for that. The feedback that we've had from members thus far is not particularly rosy. We absolutely need to be able to manage predation, and I cannot make that point in any stronger terms. And these devices, humane cable restraints, offer us an opportunity to do that. It's also important to note, convener, that in the five-year reviews that have taken place since the ascension of the Wildlife and Natural Environment Act, recommendations have been made to improve Scotland's code-compliant snare, not once, but twice, and they have not been acted upon by Scottish ministers. The recommendations have been there for some time to bring us in line with elsewhere in the UK and bring to fruition humane cable restraints. That has not happened. We have the opportunity to do so now through a well-managed land-based licensing scheme, and I really hope the minister will listen to that and bring that to fruition as an alternative and as a compromise.
Okay, thank you. Bob Elliott.
Thank you. I'm just sitting here now with a paper from, when was it, 2017, Christine Graham, Stink Pits Motion in Parliament. And it just struck me, because I've got loads of pictures of dead foxes here, foxes that were found dead in snares, and they are appalling devices. Now, on the research angle, there's a lot of play being made about capercaillie becoming extinct or curlew, etc. Now, no conservation organisation, the RSPB, Trees for Life, John Muir Trust use snares. They don't use them in their toolkit. It's about landscape management, looking at alternatives. And some really visionary stuff going on. The Clyde Valley Wader Group, which is farmers are on that, RSPB, Nature Scott. Some of the inventive ways they're growing crops there, and lapwing numbers are going up. It's really brilliant. I'm sure there's some predator control, but it's not snares. They're not using snares to do that. Also, on the capercaillie act, it's not really a great idea to be snaring around capercaillie or where there might be wildcat or protected animals like pine marten. Wildcat pine marten won't get away out of a breakaway. You're already talking about, foxes, and we're still accepting here that foxes will be snared round the neck by a device. And this is a rebranding exercise. These were called... Was it called DB snares back in the day when these were in? Glyn, there's a film of you setting them. You guys setting these. You were in 2015, you were setting one of these things, and things have not changed. Companion animals still getting caught in them. People's cats, dogs. We've had otters. The list is huge. These have been banned elsewhere in Europe. Whales have done it. We should do the same.
Okay. Connor.
I'll come back to Bob on that point about his paper and question. Those foxes that you're finding, were those with tag numbers, and were the prosecutions that came from resulted from that?
Those were all. I've got them down as legally. Doesn't make any difference whether it's an illegally set or illegal. It's still a snare.
Okay.
That's where we are now. We've had lots of reviews. We've had lots of changes. It's still not worked.
Right. And a second point on that in relation to pine marten and to capercaillie, this device has been designed with a larger stop. So that this wildcat as well, so that a smaller animal can remove itself from that. We are finding that with smaller foxes that they're actually removing themselves from it because the stop actually is as loose that they can remove themselves from that. So I would come back and just in my experience highlight that is not what we are finding. We are finding that we have had absolutely no catch of pine marten wildcat. We obviously don't have them in our area. However, pine marten GS, we have absolutely no experience of them in our HCRs.
Okay, I'm going to bring in Glenn, Penny, and then Mike.
So there's two aspects to this. One is the snare hardware, the humane cable restraint. The designs have moved on. I'm grateful for Bob name-checking me in a film that I did. That is a modern humane cable restraint, a snare that was code compliant with the Welsh Government code. That is a different design to what you've been looking at previously. So the hardware is one thing. The other aspect is setting them in the right place. And if you have non-target species, and you've mentioned many of them, you would not set them there. That would be your approach. And when we talk about injuries and things like that, one of the other key things is you set one of these devices away from risk of entanglement, because entanglement is one of the big issues that will cause injuries. So the hardware is one thing, the best practice advice of setting them, they come together to make this device compliant with international humane trapping standards.
Thank you. Penny.
Sorry. Two things I'd like to go back. First of all, to Libby's point about the fact that lambs die for any number of reasons, and yes, absolutely accept that. You know, there are a wide range of things that will impact the lamb losses, some of which you can do something about, some of which you can't. And, you know, what we're talking about here is giving them another one that they can't do anything about. To face it, and a reminder that we're asking here for them to be able to be used under licence, and as part of that licensing process you would have to meet those three levels of licensing to prove that, first of all, that you were preventing serious damage and that the action was necessary. Secondly, that...
We're going to move on to licensing in a moment, because that's not currently an option in front of us.
So we are asking about the use of licences, so we'll have to meet those tests, so that's one thing. And secondly, we're talking here about significant changes in snares, and yes, people are still using illegal snares, but we can't make legislation based on people that are hell-bent on breaking it. It will be a clearly different type of... You will be able to see what's a legal snare versus an illegal snare. So really, it's you can't take that option away because some people... are going to break the rules.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to bring in Mike and then Ross.
I'd just like to emphasise the only reason that we oppose snares 100% is the welfare issues. One, it's totally discriminate. The jobs that we go to, about half of the animals we get are non-target species, cats and badgers, etc. There have been reports made to the fiscal that have been regarding legal snares that Glyn has quite rightly said have been set illegally, and that has involved people that have been on training courses, so that excuse is out the window. And I'm glad Penny mentioned earlier on our earlier career. The injuries that we find are horrendous. I mean, I'm not talking about just a wee animal in distress, I'm talking about disembowelment and stuff. And there is no guarantee that animals will be caught round the neck with a 26-inch stop there. You get something like a badger or that round a midriff, it is going to do incredible damage. This year alone, we've had two cats that have been brought in with snare injuries. So it's just, that's the reason we oppose them. They're totally indiscriminate and they're cruel. And don't forget, foxes are sentient beings as well. And they deserve the protection. And some of the states that we've seen, some of the foxes that have come out with snares, and it's atrocious. And I'll guarantee you, any gamekeeper finding them like that would be equally appalled.
Thank you. I'm going to bring Ross McLeod, then we're going to move to our next question.
Of examples of good practice exercised, Bob mentioned the Clyde Valley Waders project. It's a very good example. We know that people... from there very well. We work with some of them, we work with the RSP members there, and we have every respect for what they do. The difficulty is that in these particular cases, they're islands, as Connor mentioned. And what we really need to do is tackle this at scale across Scotland, because the situation for instance, curlews is critical. Curlews are likely to be extinct if we're not careful, if we don't manage for these situations. The possibility that we can transfer sensible practice quickly in terms of land use in these examples over a very significant scale is, to say the least, it's going to take us a very long time. So we need other options in the interim to be able to make sure that we can balance the good work that does occasionally happen in the landscape with the immediate and pressing issue that is presented by fox predation. And if we don't take that short-term opportunities, which we think are represented by a conservation approach to licensing, then we're going to miss a big opportunity to redress the balance and transfer and remove the risk that we cannot meet the recovery of species as Scottish Government expects by 2030. We need to do something rapidly and quickly.
Just before we move on, we did touch on licensing scheme. I want to explore that a little bit more. We don't have an amendment from the Scottish Government at the moment relating to snares, because the Scottish Government suggested before the summer that they wanted to do more work to look into the various devices and whatever. The Government still haven't made that position clear. However, they did suggest that Scottish Lands and Estate had come up with a potential licensing scheme, which they've only looked at in the last few days, which is quite remarkable. I'm going to go to Nature Scotland and ask what their views are on a potential licensing scheme and where you think it's something Nature Scotland could manage.
Thank you. So, as we know, the Minister is currently considering the licensing scheme, so can't really kind of comment on that. But what I can say that obviously Nature Scotland, as a licensing authority, has considerable experience of licensing schemes. We issue about 5,000 licences a year, and in doing that, we aim to uphold the highest welfare standards that we can. In terms of if a licensing scheme were to come our way, we would obviously need the resources, because as it's set out at the moment, there's a code of practice that goes alongside it, so there's considerable thinking would need to go into that. And if it did come within our remit, then I mentioned earlier that we don't currently gather information on snaring because it's not something that we are required to do. But in the instance where if we were a licensing authority and that became a responsibility of ours, we would look to gather as much evidence as we could and do that against, say, agreement on international humane trapping standards to ensure sort of agreement with that. But it's that balancing act between the need to safeguard welfare, which we understand and accept that there are potential significant issues from snaring. But in terms of that licensing thing, obviously the Minister is currently considering that.
Can I bring in Ross Young, who proposed the licensing scheme?
Thanks, Convener. And it's worth noting that we did so in conjunction with several land management stakeholders as well. I mean, just to give you kind of a flavour of the key points of the licensing scheme that we've pulled together, Penny's already alluded to the fact that there are certain licensable purposes. Those would need to be satisfied by any prospective applicant. Secondly, they'd have to be able to evidence that no other method of fox control is reasonably practical on the land. And that brings me on to the additional safeguards that we've proposed within this licensing scheme as well. So Jess just mentioned it there. The Humane Cable Restraints Code. What we're talking about here is a statutory code of practice which land managers will have to have regard to when they are carrying out any sort of HCR use. And within that, we've already prescribed, because we know which areas the Minister has concerns, and we've said, for example, that Humane Cable Restraint Code should allude to things like how often humane cable restraints are to be checked, how humane cable restraints are to be set to reduce the likelihood of non-target catch, and how to keep records. And if that wasn't enough, Convener, what we're also including is really robust modification, suspension and revocation provisions as well. So we've given Scottish Ministers the power to modify a licence at any time, to suspend or revoke a humane cable restraint if they're satisfied that a relevant person has committed an offence, and indeed they could suspend the licence where they're not satisfied, providing proceedings against an individual or a licence holder were in order. So I think what we've proposed, Convener, constitutes a really reasonable compromise, and ultimately it will allow that crucial conservation work, that protection of livestock work, to carry on in Scotland, but under a strict licensing regime, which we have got every confidence that Nature Scotland will be able to administer and handle.
I'm going to bring Penny back in on this after I rudely interrupted her.
No, just yes, as Ross says, I do believe that if it was a use of snares under licence, and from farming situation, they don't have snares out every day, every year, constantly. It is targeted at certain times of year and at certain individual animals. So we think a licensing scheme could work. And then as part of that scheme, again, it's those three bars you'd have to pass that definitely there's a reason for your snaring, and that is that you have got lamb loss, for instance, that you know is down to a fox. So it can't just be the fact you've got some infection in your lambs, and you would have to demonstrate that you are losing lambs to foxes. You would have to demonstrate that no other alternative is possible, And I do believe that in certain situations there aren't other solutions that might be available. And thirdly, that it won't have any impact on the conservation status of the species you're targeting. So I think there's definite protections there in place that would mean that under licence it could meet that balance and be that thing that it is being used because it needs to be used.
Last week, when the Minister was in front of the committee, I asked whether Nature Scot would have an opinion on whether banning snares would have a positive or negative impact on the preservation of ground nesting birds. The Minister suggested we should ask Nature Scot, do you have an opinion on whether banning snares would be positive or negative for ground nesting birds?
Well, we know that predator impacts can have potential significant impacts on the declining productivity of certain threatened ground nesting birds, and we know that predation impacts are part of only one impact, of which there are a complex number, habitat impacts, climate, etc., and that predation itself, as I said earlier, it's really difficult to disentangle the different impacts of different predators, as was borne out in a large report understanding predation about 6 years ago. So there's a lot of complexity within that. And then, as I've mentioned earlier, we don't have, and neither do we have a requirement to understand the role of snaring as one of the suite of the predator control methods. So it's difficult to disentangle all of those different issues. But we also do recognise the significant welfare implications of snaring. So it's difficult to answer that question because there are a lot of different factors involved in it. But we do support the need for a coherent predator management control, and we do recognise that predation is one of the factors that can have an impact on ground nesting birds and biodiversity.
But I guess in isolation, looking at taking snaring out of the potential tools in the toolbox that a gamekeeper or a land manager would have, it would that have a negative impact? Because that's one of the considerations when the government make a balanced decision. Would it have a negative impact on ground nesting birds?
So there is a risk that it could have, but that's not been qualified in any way. And there are alternative methods, and it's about balancing the welfare implications with the tools available and those alternative methods, whether they can sort of step up and be used in place of snaring. It's not something that I can comment on in detail because that information we don't hold.
Okay. Glyn Evans.
I think it would have a negative effect. And I think it was the GWCT who did some research recently. And I assume that foxes are snared pretty much on a number of grass moors. And their research said that curlews, predator control on grass moors, there was four times as many curlews to other areas of similar unmanaged land. So similar areas not managed, four times as many curlews on grass moors as those things, as those areas. And it was 1.05 birds, chicks fledged, which was double what was needed to sustain the population with predator control. And I would assume snares form a big part of that in the spring of the year.
I'm aware there's another three people wish to come in the back of that, but I think it's an appropriate time to move on to a question from Rachel Hamilton, and then we can get the views again. Rachel.
Well, Convener, I think you kind of touched on it. So bringing in those other people just now would actually be beneficial, and I can pick up on anything that doesn't come up.
OK, I'm going to bring in Conor, Ross and then Bob.
Back to Jessica's point on the negative effect of fox predation on ground nesting birds, I think GWCT would absolutely have the data to show that foxes do impact on ground nesting birds and their productivity. In my own experience in our area, we find that in our lowlands, that we find with the predator control that we carry out, that we have quite successful broods of lapwing, curlew, even on the upper hills, golden plover, whereas the area, because we, as I say, we are an island, the areas round and about circumstance, they you know, the birds turn up, they try to breed, they get predated. That's, you know, by the by. So that is my experience of the impacts that foxes can have on the ground nesting birds.
Okay, Clyde.
The GWCT has undertaken substantive research in this field. The first one that is often referred to is the understanding predation experiment at Otterburn, which took place over between 2000 and 2008. And the result of that was that we could see that curlews in particular, but black game, black grouse, productivity improved dramatically. In the Otterburn example, snaring formed roughly 25% of the catch of foxes. The work was repeated and appeared in a journal in 2022. It was undertaken by my colleague Dave Baines. He looked at 18 paired sites, where we checked predator control against non-predator control, and we then swapped them around. And in one particular case, in those paired examples, 80% of the foxes were caught using humane cable restraints. But again, he pointed out in the research that he led that curlews were achieving a productivity of about 0.95. When we see the problems occurring at below 0.5. So we proved the case again. And that's why we believe that the use of predation control, and particularly snares, have a role to play in improving the lot of upland birds. And bear in mind, these birds are described as upland birds now, where they used to be on farmland. So we really need to make sure that these islands, these refugia, are resources to spread the birds back into farmland, where the landscape needs to adjust, and it's going to take time to do that.
Thank you. Bob Elliott.
Just touching on the research again, just a quick point that I noticed on the GWCT website, I was reading up about foxes, particularly the rear and release of pheasants and the studies that have been done on that. And I quote, the widespread rearing and releasing of game birds has probably improved fox food supply in autumn and winter. So a lot of this, the snaring work, is going on because people want to protect their game birds for shooting. That's essentially what's going on. There is nobody really doing much regarding snares and snares research apart from GWCT. And I think I heard Ross dismissing some of the large landscape scale projects that are going on now. They're going on, and they are. Go to the Cairngorms Connect or any of those huge Trees for Life who are connecting up habitats, thinking about why we have lots of crows and foxes in the environment, rather than here we are concentrating on snares, which is an item, an object that is cruel and indiscriminate. We've got to come back to that. We're now talking about welfare at last with these things, not just changes to design. We're talking about whether we should be catching animals in wire nooses. That's what we should be talking about here.
I'm going to bring in Ross for right to reply to that, then I'm going to move to Ross Young.
Okay, with respect to game birds, we don't see many pheasants and partridges knocking around at about 1,000, 1,500 feet in some of the grouse moors that we're operating. The point here is that we're talking about a conservation licence for these rare endangered species, which are typically an upland. I'm not at all dismissive of the issues that are taking place in landscapes. We are involved in some of them ourselves, and we think they're very important. The issue is that in terms of overall behaviour and culture about changing that landscape use to suit the birds at risk, it's going to take a long time. And in the interim, we need something which helps the cause of those birds.
Ross Young.
Thanks, convener. Just a point. The fox range in Scotland is dramatically increasing. The 2018 review of fox population in Scotland was quite clear on that. And one of the main reasons for it is the extent and scale of afforestation. And it's unsurprising, I suppose, that in the Southern Uplands and the Southern Upland Moorland Group, representatives of which are here today in the room, snaring is a particularly important method of predation control. So we see in that region, for example, of a survey I did just this week from 2021-2022, 55% of foxes in the southern upland region are snared versus 38% shot versus 7% controlled with docks. So you can see the importance of it in that respect, convener. And I think, you know, to dismiss this as an issue that's simply about producing vast numbers of game birds is fictitious and misleading. What the motivations of gamekeepers are not singular for that reason. There are multiple drivers as to why gamekeepers carry out predation control, and it is not just about game birds. I want to make that absolutely clear. And anybody that suggests that is clearly not someone that is engaged or spoken with any of the people we have at the back of the room today.
Okay. Conor Kelly.
Well, just I'll come back to the welfare point, convener. And I do get the concerns of Mike and his colleagues, you know, in terms of relation to the old conventional snare. I would ask that, you know, look at GWCT's evidence to you know, in terms of the welfare benefits, or not benefits, but certainly you've not got the same side effects or negatives from the HCR as you had from the old conventional snare. And from my experience, that we're certainly seeing an absolute reduced risk to the fox as a species in terms of in our HCRs. And also, it should be pointed out, convener, that best practice does give a set out outline stipulations that, you know, you should use in terms of to limit the non-target catch, you know, i.e. height of loop, size of loop. Again, it was pointed out earlier, I think, by Glenn, you know, entanglement area. You know, these are all things that good practitioners should be looking at, and to limit the you know, the risk of any sort of injury or damage to an animal, because nobody in this room wants that. You know, I don't want somebody stumbling across with my tag number and you know, somebody stumbling across an animal in distress or whatever. That's not, you know, it wants to be, you know, my experience is you're coming along, quite often you find them sleeping, and quick dispatch, and then move on. So
thank you. I've got a supplement from Kate Forbes.
Very briefly, because I was slightly concerned that we may be losing sight of the fact that the issue before is snaring rather than the validity of certain sectors or otherwise. And if all sectors are agreed on the need for predator control, whether that's conservation, agriculture or anything else, my question is, would a licensing scheme actually enable better enforcement? Because, as Penny Middleton outlined, it requires you to jump through certain hoops rather than pushing some of the illegal activity further underground.
Thank you. Ross Young.
That's absolutely spot on. I'd agree with that completely. The revocation, suspension and modification provisions that we've included in the draft licensing scheme are robust. And I think the other thing to add to this, convener, that in light of the fact that there was no impact assessment actually done as to what the implications of this particular proposal would be, I think really the onus is on the Scottish Government to ensure that they do put in some sort of interim measure that will enable the use of HCRs to continue. And it was really, really regrettable, I think, certainly when we were looking at the consultation that came out, you know, there was the statement was made that, you know, the use of live capture traps, for example, were more humane and more efficient. That is just not the case. And I think it's really important that we recognise that as a conservation tool, these things are vital. And as Kate Forbes has just outlined, it will allow land managers to make sensible applications for specified purposes where no other method of fox control is available. We're talking about these limited circumstances on places like the place that Connor works, where they're absolutely fundamental.
Okay. Thank you. Rachel, do you have anything to sweep up on that?
Well, I'm just glad that there's been a sort of an explanation about between the differentiation of the humane cable restraints and, you know, the ban on the traditional snare itself here, because I think in a way we were starting to get a little bit, both were starting to get conflated, and that therefore means that we need to be looking at an exemption in terms of the use of this, and also, as Ross Ewing has just said, possibly an impact assessment on the use of humane cable restraints. But my question really goes to GWCT and to Conor Kelly on the minister's as sort of statement last week, that she said that people could use shooting and trapping, which were available to land managers, and I wondered how effective shooting and trapping were. And if you, and particularly GWC, if you have any information on the effectiveness of live capture of predators.
Yeah, we'll move to Ross McLeod and then Conor Kelly.
Thank you. With regard to the mix of options, we've been collecting data through an app, which has been rolled out to 26 upland estates to look at the proportion, the mix, if you like. I think off the top of my head, it's about 39-40% of foxes are managed by snaring, by HCRs, and 60-61% is by shooting. Within that mix, it included 1,000 man days of operating cage traps as an alternative. No foxes were taken. So we therefore concentrate on the issue about whether shooting makes up the shortfall if HCRs happen to be removed. A 40% is a lot to make up, particularly when shooting is not always possible. It's been outlined that in circumstances where deep cover is present, it's not possible to shoot where you can't see. It's also unsafe under those circumstances, particularly where you've got other people moving around the landscape. So there are issues about shooting. You can't always use thermals, particularly when it's damp or wet. So again, there are the possibility that shooting makes up the shortfall is just impossible to imagine.
Yeah. So, touching on Ross's point, we find shooting very effective. However, there is that shortfall. You know, we shoot probably 30. It's kind of role reversed in that sense of 61% of our foxes are snared or caught in humane cable restraints because it's quite steep topography. We are heavily forested on all sides, surrounded by commercial forestry. So. There's just it's not physically possible to shoot the number, you know, of foxes or control the number of foxes. To our best efforts, we do try. However, the use of humane cable restraints is absolutely vital, especially when, you know, the hunting with dogs has just been removed. And I know there's with Nature Scot, I know of one case that's went forward so far and that's been rejected, and that's in Perthshire. So that's not exactly filling me full of reassurance, if I'm being honest. So the toolkit is becoming less and less, and I understand the technology is getting better, thermal equipment is getting better, but it still doesn't take, you know, I can still not see the tops of hills. You know, you have to take into consideration things like fog and other things. So we can't carry out our farming control on the need with the need that we need to. It's certainly not. We're in dire straits if HCRs are not left as an option with under licence.
Okay. Thank you. Move on to a question from Alistair Allen.
Thank you, convener. Just in terms of how the operation of snaring offences under the bill might work, I wonder if I could say anything or if anyone has a view on the issue that we've touched on in this committee before about vicarious liability and how it might apply and what the consequences of it might be.
Anyone like to comment on vicarious liability? Ross?
Yeah, I just say I think it broadly was covered last week. You know, we're not aware of any VL offences in relation to kind of existing snaring offences, so I don't really see the need. The other thing I'd highlight, of course, is that, you know, and the review, the 2022 review, was quite clear on this. The majority of a legal snare operation tends to be around those are committed to undertaking a legal operation. It's not people that are sanctioned to do so in a certain way. You know, I think we're not going to be able to ever stop those that are going to act on the wrong side of the law. You know, that will continue irrespective of whether snares, cable restraints are banned or not. So I think when we're looking at kind of, you know, what is the aim of this legislation? Ultimately, a ban on snares is not going to stop illicit operators like poachers and people that persecute badgers for continuing to do what they're doing. So I don't really see the case for vicarious liability, to be honest.
Okay. Bob Elliott.
Thank you, convener. My only experience was when I was working for RSPB when vicarious liability came in. I think I might have been on this committee at one point. And it can be a powerful tool to drive change. But I would, again, just come back to the main point about the welfare aspects of snares. So whether they're set illegally or legally, it's still the same impact on the fox that's being snared. And I think that's why we're here today, because we've moved on. This debate has moved on from the basics of predator control. This is a device that shouldn't be used in it for any reason at all.
Jim Fowler with a supplementary.
It's just...
Thanks, Convener. It's just on the idea of vicarious liability. If a person's entire livelihood is put at risk as a result of doing something illegal, setting an illegal snare, surely vicarious liability is an important tool to be able to ensure that it's only going to be legal set snares that are set by estates and farmers who are trying to do the right thing.
Ross. That, Convener. I mean, I think what we would argue would be a sensible compromise, and our licensing scheme sort of speaks to this, because it's a land-based licensing scheme. If a relevant individual, i.e. someone acting at the the incidence of a landowner, was to deliberately set a humane cable restraint in an illegal fashion, Nature Scot as the regulator would have the power to suspend, revoke or modify that licence, and it would cover the entire landholding. So the implication would be felt not just by the individual but by the estate at large, and I personally think that gives, the regulator sufficient discretion to say, actually, we do not have trust and confidence that proper practices are being followed in this particular place, and therefore the entire landholding should be subject to a suspension or a revocation. I think that constitutes a fair compromise. I don't think vicarious liability will be required. I think our licensing scheme achieves the aim.
Thank you. Yes.
We've been involved in many snaring cases and vicarious liability has never come up. There's never been any evidence that it was carried out on behalf or at the instruction or knowledge of the landowner or the factor or agent.
Thank you. Just on that, so I posed a question a number of times to the Minister on the convictions and whatever. So at the moment there's quite strict guidelines, as we've heard from Conor Kelly, about the way snares are currently set. How many convictions or how many cases have you investigated where snares have been set legally and resulted in a bad outcome?
You've got to remember, a lot of what could be classed as wildlife crime never gets to the fiscal, never reaches court. So we've found lots of instances where an animal has suffered and it has been, as I explained earlier, because of bad practice, putting it on fence lines and stuff, which is against the law. I mean, you've got to remember, we've been discussing this for at least 15 years and it was always getting better. We'll put the stop at 23 centimetres, we'll stop drag snares, we'll stop putting them on fence lines and stuff, and it's still going on.
But is it going on from licensed operator, or is it going on with people who are illegally setting snares?
That's what I said earlier. There is two cases currently with the Procurator Fiscal that have been involved people who have been on training courses. So it's not as if they didn't know the exact law. They've actually been on the training course. So it does happen.
But I suppose my point is this legislation will make it doubly illegal, because currently the cases that you see are snares that are being set illegally. So actually banning them probably won't make any difference. It's currently illegal because when you get animals that are caught indiscriminately or the snare's not been set properly, it's illegal.
Yeah, it's two different things there, Convener. One, the actual legality, but two, coming back to what Bob says, the method used is inhumane. It's cruel. Snaring's not designed to kill the animal, but invariably, in many cases, it does. And it's not a very quick, pleasant death.
But that's currently illegal.
Yes, and yeah. It'd be illegal if in the future if this is brought into place.
Okay. I think Ross wanted to just come in and then I'll bring you in for the final.
So, I mean, I think the policy intention here is to stop undue suffering to animals that are potentially caught in snares or cable restraints, right? The point and the central point here is this, and the review group of 2022 said this, it would be very difficult to legislate for the actions of individuals where the modus operandi is to undertake an act of snaring with the intention of committing an associated offence, i.e. those people that are absolutely committed to committing offences are going to continue to do so. And Convener, you asked for facts and figures on this, and I'm happy to provide that. So again, the 2022 review of snaring for the Scottish Government, there were 18 cases of standard prosecution reports received by the Procurator Fiscal. Four of those resulted in the cases being prosecuted. That's basically the kind of ratio you've got there, and it sets it out also for 2012 to 2016. So the Scottish Government have got this information available because they commissioned it, but that is all set out in the latest review of snaring.
Okay. Finally, Rachel Hamilton.
Well, it's just to reiterate, Mike, are you saying that you still believe that illegal snaring will continue by those who are bad practitioners or poachers, even if this legislation is in place?
You'll always get illegality. I'm not saying that there is a need for the use of snares. again, it comes back to the actual suffering that's caused by them, that it's unnecessary. And for, I'll put it on the record, I do not believe for one second any bona fide gamekeeper has ever put a snare out with the intention of causing an animal to suffer. I'm not saying that's their intention, but that's in reality what happens.
Well, yeah, can you put some figures behind some of this?
We've got figures of the cases that we've investigated and reported to Procurator Fiscal, and I can get them to you this afternoon, the whole committee, not a problem.
That would be useful.
Thank you, Mike.
Ross McLeod.
Want to make one point. We've talked about the use of app technology to understand what's happening as far as foxcatch is concerned, and that has improved dramatically our understanding of what's going on. I think looking back about the two iterations of the five-year review since the introduction of Wildlife and Natural Environment Act, there has been a collective failure, and that's just to bring the information together. So if we are in a position where a licensing system is introduced, I think it's incumbent on both our side to produce evidence about what's happening, not just in relation to fox predation and the catch rate, but also what's happening in terms of conservation benefit. Equally, I think it's incumbent upon the authorities like SSPCA to be clear in the information about where incidents are happening, whether it's illegal, legal, whether it's involving tags, where these are taking place as well, because that might give us a clear idea about whether this is happening in the rural environment or whether it's happening in suburbia, wherever. I think that would help immensely.
OK, I've got Libby Anderson and then Penny Middleton.
Put on record that the Commission would not be supporting any exception under licensing. In terms of HCR, while the technology of the snare itself may be different, is different, the peripheral effects, the fundamental effects of being restrained in a wire noose over a period of hours are not affected by that. If there was to be a licensing scheme, we would not support the proposal that's been tabled at present. It's far more permissive than the current legislation or other licensing schemes. And as a quick example of that, to base a licensing scheme on a code rather than regulations, which would be the normal approach, is more permissive. And there's an assumption in this proposal that ministers must grant licences subject to certain exceptions, and that again is the opposite of the normal procedure. So I won't go into more detail at present, but I think we would not be able to support that.
I've got final speakers, Penny Middleton, Glenn Evans, and then Ross Young.
Just wanted to go back to what Mike Flynn was saying about the cases where they have seen suffering in snares, and just that clarity on whether I heard incorrectly, that the cases where they have seen suffering in snares, those snares have been illegally set. So they've been set in a manner that doesn't follow the best practice and doesn't follow how they should be used. If we're coming down to the welfare, pure welfare argument, if these new style of humane cable restraints are used in the manner to which they are designed to be used, they will significantly reduce suffering.
OK, thank you. Glenn. OK, thank you.
Yeah, so it sort of builds on what Mark just said. If you have a code of practice that enshrines you have to use the right device in the right way, that should alleviate the concerns that Mike has just raised.
Thank you. And finally, Ross.
Thank you, Convener. Libby Anderson has mischaracterised our licensing scheme because it's a rebuttable presumption in favour of granting licences. There's a distinction, and the reason that there is a distinction is that basically NatureScot would have to be satisfied that another method of fox control is reasonably, or would have to be not satisfied that rather that another method of fox control is reasonably practical prior to granting a licence. So that is the safeguard that's in there. The second point I'd add in terms of kind of the strength of the code of practice, NatureScot would be able to suspend, revoke, or modify someone's licence based on them not, an individual not having regard to the code of practice. That is a strong, robust licensing scheme.
Okay. Thank you all very much. We've now run out of time. That's been hugely useful. Thank you for your evidence you've provided this morning. We'll suspend the meeting until 11:30.
Welcome back, everyone. Our second roundtable this morning will focus on the proposed extension of powers of the Scottish SPCA. And we have, once again, approximately 1 hour for questions and discussion. So I'll start, as previously, just going round the table. This morning, we have Ian Batho from the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service. We have Chief Inspector Kevin Kelly from the National Wildlife Crime Unit. Ian Thompson from RSPB Scotland. Once again, Ross Ewing from Scottish Land and Estates. We have Detective Sergeant David Lynn from Police Scotland. Susan Davis, who is the review lead on the Independent Task Force on SSPCA powers. And once again, Chief Inspector, Chief Superintendent Mike Flynn from the Scottish SSPCA. And we'll start with questions from Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, Convener. Given that there's a number of members of the task force on this panel, I'd be interested to hear how you came to your recommendations of increased partnership working and why the group was not able to agree on a recommendation to expand the Scottish SPCA powers. What were the key concerns and how are they addressed under the proposed compromise position? And maybe if I could start with Susan Davis.
Thank you for that. The remit that I was given was to try and reach an agreement with Police Scotland and the Crown Office on the way forward. And it wasn't possible through that route to get to either option one or option two, which is set out in the task force. There was a lot of support for improved working together and a lot of good examples of where people across the partnership really work very effectively together. But there were some valid concerns which were raised about the extent of the scope of the powers. And that was why in the final report and my cover letter back to Scottish Government and to the Minister, we actually set out option two, which potentially gave a way forward, but it was not possible in the timescale of the review to actually get agreement from either Police Scotland or the Crown Office to option two at that time. And I think that is because some of the detail of some of the safeguards which would be required still need to be worked through.
Thank you. Anybody else want to comment on thoughts on that?
Mike, have you got any comments on the protocol?
Protocol, we've said all along, we'll go along with whatever protocols put in place. And I'd like to thank Susan for all the work that she did during that task force review.
I've got a question. So last week, asked the Minister whether the legislation that formed set about how the SSPCA would work and how their powers would be extended, whether those powers would be enacted prior to a protocol being agreed. And the Minister said that's something that could come forward as an amendment or whatever. Can I ask Susan, first of all, what's your thoughts on the enactment of part of a bill if there's not an agreement between SSPCA and Police Scotland?
Yeah, I think it would be a pragmatic step to take to provide that safeguard. But I think it also needs a timeline on it. This is an issue which has been around since 2010, if not before. And I think, you know, what option two does is actually, you know, take us forward to a resolution on the issue. So it would be important that, you know, there's a strong commitment to work on the detail of those protocols and to put it in place, you know, fairly quickly after the legislation is in place. I think the other thing that I would say is that, you know, the approach will take some time to bed in and there will be issues. But if there is that real commitment to partnership working alongside it, again, these organisations will work through that in a sensible manner.
OK. Same question to Mike.
As I say, we're ready to go with the protocol as soon as it's put forward by the police and agreed by the Crown Office.
But what involvement will you have in actually agreeing that protocol?
We've not seen what's actually been suggested yet, but I see absolutely no reason why we couldn't agree with what is potentially coming down the line.
OK. Ian Batho, can I get your perspective on how the protocol would set up and whether that should that should be the trigger to enforcing the additional powers?
Our position is that we can neither
endorse or oppose the proposals at this stage in the absence of detailed legislative proposals and drafts of any proposed safeguards, such as a memorandum of an understanding between the Police Scotland and SSPCA. I suppose our position is that we are ultimately governed by the law and the rules of evidence, and so the devil will be in the detail from our point of view. So I think we would be in favour of these safeguards being drafted in advance of the bill coming into place.
Thank you. Police Scotland, any comments?
Well, I don't speak on behalf of Police Scotland, as I'm not a Police Scotland officer, but on behalf of the implementation of the policing of UK wildlife crime. With any new legislation or practices, there does sit risk with it. I think an agreed protocol is the first step to look at mitigating any risks that could be seen. Are these going to be used reactively? Are they going to be used proactively? Where does this align with disclosure requirements upon policing? I think it's a positive step forward as demand on policing rises and services get deviated elsewhere. We are looking, certainly from an England and Wales perspective, I've advised on a project like this where we've had legislative change and we are looking more towards partners. But it sits around the management of the changes and how we mitigate that risk, and also how people are trained within that as well.
Okay, thanks. David Lynn.
Convener. Yeah, so Police Scotland have the view there needs to be a very, very clear protocol with well-defined roles and responsibilities in order for this to work successfully if these new powers are enacted. And, of course, we could sit down with SSPCA, with the Crown, and we could get our heads together and make sure we create a protocol that suits everyone's needs and will ensure that there's no unintended consequences of additional powers being afforded to the SSPCA.
Okay, thank you. And finally, Mike, the Scottish Government consultation resulted in the Scottish Government describing the scope of new powers as a compromise. And what areas do you think that the Scottish Government think that the powers that you've got are a compromise, and where would you like to see them go further?
I'm not sure what the government's meaning by a compromise from their side. I think originally the original intention, which was first suggested by Mr Peter Peacock, MSP, back in 2010, was to grant us powers under Section 19 of the Wildlife and Countryside Act, which covers a multitude of things. It's now been narrowed down to extending the powers that we've currently got under the 2006 Act. If an animal is live at the time we go there, which our inspectors do because it's the public that call us, so we'd extend what we could do at that point. Obviously, Police Scotland still have the primacy in all things there. And regardless of the protocol, ultimately, it's the fiscal's decision on whether anything goes to court, and the fiscal is the experts in ensuring that all evidence is gathered lawfully, there's substantial evidence there to take it forward, or the fiscal will just not carry it forward.
So in practice, if you were called under the existing powers of the 2006 Act to an animal caught live in a live trap, if it died when you arrived, would the new powers allow you to then carry an investigation into a suspected wildlife crime?
For that individual animal there. I mean, now, funny you mention that, because it's not that long ago. The animal was alive in a snare and died while our inspector was standing over it, just because, again, it struggled to try and get away. That was the ultimate cause of death there. So that there, but if you look up and there's other traps there, we've got to leave the scene, get Police Scotland, which is not always available immediately. Now, I have to put my hand on my heart, we could not do our job on a day-to-day basis, and I'm talking about the whole remit of everything we do without Police Scotland. The service we get is very good, but like all services, they're getting tired. They've got far more demands on their time than we'll ever have.
OK. Alistair Allen.
Thanks. I appreciate, Mike, you've touched on some of this, and others have touched on it as well. I also appreciate there is no law or legal framework for you to operate within yet, but just for people looking in on this so they understand what option two is and compromise is, can somebody just say whether they have an understanding or a shared understanding of who does what under that option? Police or SSPCA or anyone who wants to?
At the moment, our inspectors are authorised under the 2006 Act, which is where an animal is alive and under the control of man. So there's there. But it does not stop us investigating wildlife and countryside offences. And as I said previously, ultimately, anything we do, and 99 times out of 100, we're working in conjunction with the Police Scotland anyway, but ultimately the report goes to the fiscal, and it's the fiscal that's got the ultimate decision. So that will not change, regardless of protocol, is whether the report eventually goes to the fiscal from Police Scotland or the Scottish SPCA. It's the fiscal that has the ultimate decision. And there have been instances, and I've mentioned it before, with badger baiting, where it was actually the police that suggested, because of the time and the expertise we've got on it, we actually finalised the reports that went to the fiscal, and I've never heard any concern or complaints about that.
Thank you. A question from Karen Adam. Sue, beg your pardon.
Sorry, the only additional thing that I was going to add is that what this really gives is it gives the SSPCA the powers to collect and preserve evidence, which they currently don't have if that animal is dead when they arrive on site. And that seems a sensible extension of the current situation. And that is backed up by kind of training in terms of how to gather that evidence, how to preserve that evidence. That's the step that they get.
David Lynn.
I think we can't lose sight of the huge importance and significance of those early stages of an investigation. We just need to bear that in mind. We could have an incident that starts out, appears to be relatively simple, items are seized, but it could develop into a very big police investigation, a very big police inquiry involving numerous people. It could involve numerous areas. And ultimately, the bottom line is that a case could fall. A case could be taken no further because of a misstep at the very early stages of investigation, for example, when evidence is seized, when a locus is identified and things. So I do totally appreciate certainly Mike's point. You know, Police Scotland maybe aren't always able to respond immediately then and there. However, we just need to bear in mind the importance of those very early stages of investigation. It's not something we can talk about as if it's not hugely important.
Sorry, Mike, just wait for your mic. Mike Flynn.
Sorry. Just to concur with what David's saying there, but to be fair, the evidence required to meet a criminal standard, doesn't matter if it's a domestic animal what or a wildlife animal, the evidence requirements are the same. You've got to have your locus, your evidence of an accused. And that's what I was saying in the last session. There's a lot of things that are genuinely wildlife crime. An animal's there, it's suffered illegally, you never find an accused person, you can never prove an accused person, so it never gets to the fiscal because you've got no evidence to actually say it's an individual that's responsible. So the risk about gathering evidence at any stage is the same regardless of what type of animal is involved.
David, do you want to come back in?
I suppose it comes down to the frequency with which we use these kind of powers and things. So for things like, police officers are obviously, I would suggest experts in, you know, identifying opportunities, evidential opportunities. There may be other considerations. There could be forensic considerations, for example, that may not be immediately obvious to someone who's not maybe got that investigative mind to the same extent. So I think it's just making sure. I think key to this, if the powers are afforded to the SSPCA, I think training and making sure a reasonable standard is met will be absolutely key. Training will be absolutely key to this, to make sure, you know, a standard has been held.
I think Rachel and then Jim.
Yeah, it's just some clarity on what happens if the protocols cannot be agreed between Police Scotland and SSPCA. In that circumstance, will the powers be extended to the SSPCA? I'll maybe go to Ian. Is that the right person?
Ian, I think you've more or less touched on that.
I know, I want to be clear on that, though.
I think, first and foremost, the protocols are primarily going to be between the police and the SSPCA and determine the way in which they work. Ultimately, our standards of evidence remain the same, whoever reports the evidence to us. And so, in general terms, as long as the standards of evidence are met, we don't really mind who gathers that evidence. But I think our point of view is that there is an increased risk when offences are investigated by specialist reporting agencies compared to the police. And I think it needs to be acknowledged that there is a difference in the level of training and experience of sort of criminal investigation between the police and specialist reporting agencies. And that risk can come into the way in which evidence is gathered, the admissibility of evidence, and ultimately whether there is sufficient evidence for us to prosecute. And so I think there needs to be an acknowledgement of those risks, but our position is that there, if certain safeguards are in place, and our main safeguards, I think we are in support of a protocol between the SSPCA and the police. The main safeguards that we would primarily be in favour of are an enhanced level of training for SSPCA inspectors, particularly with a view to, you know, the standards required in order for them to get approved by Scottish ministers to become an inspector. And I suppose more generally, another safeguard we'd be looking for is some kind of increased accountability for SSPCA in the form of additional formal procedures to enable independent scrutiny of the SSPCA. And I think one purpose that would serve was to enhance sort of public confidence and faith in the investigation of wildlife offences.
Briefly, Jim. So I'm just going to... Jim's got a supplementary.
Yeah, thank you very much, Convener. David, yourself, Kevin, this is probably more important to you, but it is actually directed at Mike. And if that sounds complicated, it'll make sense. You're talking about the level of training and the inquisitive mind, the inquiring mind that you would need to do that kind of investigation. You clearly know what that looks like and what that feels like. And Mike, with all due respect, talking to what Ian's saying, there is a different level of inspection or gathering of evidence at the very early stages. So, what level of training would you get? Would it be through Police Scotland? And as importantly, how would you pay for it? Because I understand that all the funding that you get is through charitable donations. Is that, first of all, is that correct? And if it is correct, how would you pay for that level of training?
Well, one, yes, we are entirely a charity. We get no government, central or local government money. My understanding, other than time, there's been no indication about a cost. And if there is a cost, if we were on to pay to go on a training course, and it's not just being trained by Police Scotland, then that's something that we would have to look at, because up till now, it would be any training we required on this aspect would come from Police Scotland or the Crown Office, if that was relevant with the gathering evidence. And I have to go back to my point, and I'm going to bring in the badger baiting aspect again. It's the same complexities. The big thing, from my point of view, where the police are concerned, is the early notification of anything we are doing. And that way, if it impinges on anything else that the police are doing, they could inform us and it comes back. And where that comes into place at the moment is, if we've got enough evidence to report a matter to the fiscal, we've got to raise a Scottish criminal records number to go with the case to the fiscal. As soon as we apply for that number, the police are alerted that we've got an interest in this person. And at that point, if it's a firearms issue or the police have got a serious concern about anything, and we get contacted on, not regular, but occasionally by the serious and organised crime squads, saying, what is your interest in this person? And then we will pass our information. I'm assuming, and I would hope, that this protocol would lead to the fact that, and it was myself that individually suggested it, that the police are aware of what we're doing at an earlier stage. And if there's any concerns that there could be a crossover in any other form of criminality, that then the police can address that aspect. I hope that makes sense to everybody. It makes sense to me.
Susan.
Thanks, Convener. I think the other thing which came to light during the review process, it was around the question of evidence and the standards for evidence. And what came from the Crown Office representative through that process is that whether it's Police Scotland or whether it's SSPCA, if issues have been raised about the standards of evidence gathering, that has been taken on board, and together they have worked to improve that. And so again, in that partnership sense, there's a continuous kind of improvement that can be taken. And I don't imagine that under scenario two that would be any different. If there was an issue about the standard of evidence, it would be addressed by the SSPCA in the same way it has in the past, or in the same way that issues have been raised about Police Scotland evidence.
David, what's the come?
Yeah, thanks, Convener. It was just to make a point in, with regards to Mike's point there. For a protocol, ideally, we would be looking for, you're absolutely right, Mike, we would ideally be looking for notification before, during, or immediately after the execution of these new powers, so we could make an assessment in terms of any work we have ongoing, whether we want to, you know, drop everything and come and be involved, or we can have a follow-up discussion at a meeting in the aftermath to decide where we're going to go, what direction it's going to go. Are we going to are we going to take on this case? Is it something potentially SSPCA could report to the fiscal? So that communication would be absolutely key again, before, during, or immediately after. We'd be looking for that to be quite tight timescale in writing.
Ross Ewan.
Convener, and just to add our thanks to Professor Davies for her to conducting the review in a really rigorous way. In terms of our expectations for training, if this is going to come to fruition, our expectation would be, and it's set out in paragraph 26 of Professor Davies's review, but we would hope that anybody involved with investigating wildlife crime would complete the Wildlife Crime Officer 2-day induction course, and along with the Investigator Training Course, which is a 1-week long training course and repeated twice a year, and indeed more advanced training for those that are perhaps exercising additional powers. Whether that's relevant, I don't know. But I think the salient point here is that those two training courses, which ultimately underpin the investigation of wildlife crime in Scotland, our expectation would be that SSPCA inspectors who are charged and granted these additional powers prior to that happening would have to complete those exact requisite courses.
Kevin.
Thank you. I think DS Lynn summarises the deconfliction issue around it when you've got two organisations using similar powers. The notifications before, during or after. I think the during and after is a really good governance process. So if you have powers and you take every reasonable step to notify Police Scotland, that shows good governance. The only thing I'd put out there for stakeholders to consider is before notifications. We have had issues previously in England and Wales with pre-notifications technically becoming an agent of the police, and that's now is the right time to discuss that. If you're getting powers that are to be used reactively, the pre-notification, we have to have the open discussion around where does that sit, because it's got to be deconflicted.
Can I just answer that? Professor Susan can back me up on that. It was me that suggested that if anything involved us, that we call 101 before we even enter, and that way, because half the problem we've had is that we do call for police assistance and there is nobody available immediately. So it was my suggestion, we phone 101, here's what I'm doing, I'm going in here, that goes to the mainframe police, it goes to the relevant bit. If they want to turn up at the exact same time, brilliant, but if not, at least they know about it and they've got the contact number and how to deal with it after.
I'm going to bring in Ian in this.
I suppose one thing to bear in mind is that approach works if there's an anticipation that you're going to come across certain evidence that falls under sort of a wildlife offence. But I suppose one of the issues is the SSPCA attending not in anticipation of finding such evidence. And what happens then when, essentially in exercising your 2006 powers under an animal health and welfare issue, you stumble across wildlife evidence? And then I suppose our concern is that in that moment that everything is in place for the evidence to be gathered lawfully and properly. So I think that's the sort of issue when evidence is stumbled across. We'd be interested to see sort of how that would work.
Bring it back in, Kevin.
From a practical working point of view, that would be you're out there, you're doing your job, you come across something that you need your additional powers. Good governance would be do you 101 as you do. You either get Police Scotland interest or you don't, and if you don't, then you can fall back on your new additional powers and that provides your governance process. Absolutely.
Yeah. To a point you raised earlier, Ross, that, well, they're just out there trying to find stuff. We've already informed the police that this is the land we're going on to and the reason why, which 99 times out of 100 is because of a complaint we've received from a member of the public. That's information that we tend to be dealing on.
What I'm going to do, I'm going to jump questions, so members, please don't get in a panic that I'm missing out questions, but I think it's probably appropriate to go to the question that Rhoda Grant was going to ask on resources and training. Because I think it ties in with the conversation we're having at the moment. Rhoda.
Thank you, Convener. For Mike, I wonder if you are going to need more, we've talked about training, but more trained officers to carry out this role. Do you see that role expanding with the new powers? And also, what are the resourcing impacts of all of this? I know that you're closing offices in Caithness in my constituency. I don't suppose we're the only ones having SSPCA offices closed. Have you the resources to take on this work?
This is all based on the fact that we're already there dealing with it. I mean, the issues of the offices, and it's not offices, it was our kennels in Balmore and Ayr have closed, but that's part of our community engagement model, which is a totally separate arm of the Scottish SPCA, and it's a 10-year vision for us to improve the service we've got for pet owners and the public. The inspectorate side, this all came about because we're already there dealing with our members, member of the public's concern, and that we can deal with the immediate animal that's there, but we're not allowed to do anything surrounding that area. So there's no plan on increasing our resource. We're not going to put in an extra 20 inspectors or anything, and it'll not be all inspectors that will end up being trained and doing the proper training. So there's no additional resource. There should be no additional cost to us. And in a way, it might actually save us money because we're there. Then we've got to go and involve the police at the moment, wait until they're available, and then we've got to go back. A lot of the things that we could have done, we could have just done there in the first visit, obviously part of the protocol and all that stuff. So there's no additional resource getting put into place by the Scottish SPCA. We're not going to be employing more inspectors to deal with the fact that we've got this slight extension to the 2006 Act.
David Lynn's indicated to come in, and then I'll come to Ian Bathell.
Just with regards to Police Scotland's training, we do indeed run two wildlife crime training courses, a two-day introductory course and a five-day more advanced investigators course. It would need to be a decision made at executive level, really, as to whether SPCA could sit in on these training courses. That wouldn't be for me to say today or commit to today. The five-day course, for example, there are some inputs that wouldn't really be suitable for the SPCA to be present for with regards to like, covert policing methods and things like that. So it's certainly not necessarily just a given that we could incorporate the SSPC into our current training model. We may need to devise some sort of new system. And again, that would need that kind of executive support. So that might not be quite as straightforward as maybe it seems at the moment.
Okay. Ian Bathell.
Just in relation to resourcing, I think it's important to note that the role of a reporting agency extends well beyond the initial seizure of evidence. Now, the agency that ultimately reports the case to us is responsible for that case moving forward in terms of sort of providing the evidence to us, providing the report. Our preference would be for any offences involving a wildlife charge to be reported by Police Scotland. But I suppose if the bill was to allow the SSPCA to report wildlife offences to us, we would want some assurances that they are effectively resourced to do the follow-up work after that point. So our requirements is that we require an agency to report cases to us timeously, to submit all evidence to us effectively and properly, and then to make potential further inquiries throughout the life of the cases we require it. So I think we would need some assurances from the SSPCA that they are effectively resourced to do that ongoing work if they were to report these additional offences to us.
Yes, Mike Flynn.
Just look at the badger cases we've put in. That involves postmortems, veterinary statements, third-party statements. We're already doing that. And if we weren't, your department would be the first to tell us.
Ross Yuan.
Briefly, Convener, thank you for bringing me in. Professor Davies' review again kind of gives, I suppose, makes a point of reference as to kind of what sort of number of wildlife crime incidents are generally reported each day, citing Police Scotland data. So there's around 5,000 incidents reviewed daily by Police Scotland, of which five, on average, are suspected to be wildlife crime instances. So I suppose just to give, I suppose, the committee a flavour of, I suppose, the sort of the demand that could be expected, we would probably also like some reassurances that that would be something that the Scottish SPCA could handle in terms of their resourcing.
Okay, thank you. Susan.
Thank you, and thank you, Ross, for elevating me to Professor. Ms. will do for the record. I think there is an important kind of piece which Ross has also highlighted there, which is the education piece with the public, which is again is a kind of function of the Partnership Against Wildlife Crime as to what a wildlife crime actually is, so that the right things are being reported through 101 or the other kind of reporting measures to be followed up as well, and that helps limit the scope in terms of the amount of resource which gets drawn into things which are not actually a wildlife crime.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to move on to a question from Karen Adam. Thank you.
I think my question has been extensively answered through a lot of supplementaries, but just to drill into maybe some of the detail of that we haven't heard, really talking about a point on official investigation and what that actually means has been a bit of a bone of contention. It's raised some concerns with stakeholders. And at what point would an official investigation be launched. I think the concerns have came from the fact that, you know, a licence could be suspended at that point. So just throwing that out, what do we actually mean by official investigation?
David Lynn.
So I think part of the protocol, I think, should state that only Police Scotland can notify Nature Scott of, you know, information that they could then sort of suspend, whether it's a general licence or a licence under the Grosvenor Management, the legislation that's going through just now. So I think it's key that it's only Police Scotland that can sort of trigger that process from Nature Scott. I don't think that should fall under this. Personally, from Police Scotland's perspective, we don't think that responsibility should fall under the SSPCA. Certainly, so that will be very important from our perspective, certainly.
Process, it would be the information passed to the police, them to assess it and then advise Nature Scott if that was relevant.
And then, just in terms of an official investigation, it entirely depends what you consider an official investigation to be, really, as to when that starts. Because as I said at a previous session, as soon as someone makes contact with the police, an incident is raised. So some could consider that to be an investigation commencing, because there will have to be some sort of follow-up with that. Some may consider an investigation to start when a witness statement, the first witness statement or a statement from a complainer or a witness is taken. So it's really quite subjective. There's no definitive answer really as to when an official investigation starts. It just depends what you consider to be an official investigation, really.
I think that's where the problem lies, is that the legislation states an official investigation, and last week the Minister suggested that would be on the production of a crime number. So there's still some grey areas over that. I'll bring in Ross Ewing on that.
Thanks, Convener. So, I mean, yeah, the establishment of an official investigation as being the basis for licence suspension, in our view, is completely inadequate. We don't think it's potentially legally sound either. Obviously, reference was made last week to the allocation of a crime reference number being the basis on which a licence could be suspended. And I'll quote here from the Scottish Government's own recording and counting rules published in October 2023, which kind of gives a bit of insight as to when a crime reference number is actually allocated. So it says on page 8, in the main, incidents reported to the police as crimes will result in a corresponding crime report being created. And the inference that we've kind of taken from that is that genuinely it's a case of an allegation sometimes does result in a crime number being allocated. That is really no difference to where we started from with regards to the establishment of an official investigation, and in our view does not provide sufficient legal safeguards to prospective licence holders that actually they couldn't be the subject of a vexatious allegation or something to that effect. So we would robustly go against the proposal that was floated by the Minister last week. We do not think it's inadequate in any way, shape or form.
Kevin Kelly.
Thank you. I mean, there's a number of issues at play there because people have got the right to report a crime. People can report things and that quite often they're at conflict. As far as an investigation goes, I've always been personally really clear. It's at the point that you suspect something, and that's a really good point of measurement, that when you suspect that a crime's happened, your investigation starts. There are lots of administrative activities that can take place before you reach that point of suspicion. They may be the foundations to get into that point. That's probably something for discussion as we look at MOUs potentially around it all, but being really clear, investigations start at the point of a suspicion of a crime, because if you're just investigating somebody and you don't suspect them, that's not right.
This is certainly something that has caused the committee quite a few concerns. The Minister last week said, we are looking at a few options, but I am currently minded to make that when something has a crime number. Can I have the views, again, Kevin Kelly and David, on that?
Thank you. So if you ring the control room and report something, it will naturally go to an incident number, so you get issued an incident number. So a hypothetical scenario is like you wake up after a night out and you don't have your mobile phone, so you ring up and go, somebody's stolen my mobile phone, so you can claim on your insurance. There's actually no metrics in there of actually, have you lost it drunk, because that's a general incident number, or has somebody stolen it, because that's a crime number. So having a number doesn't always accurately reflect the report that sits behind it. That's a process issue, and that's something that's current within policing that probably wouldn't be remedied, but at the point you suspect a crime, it goes from a general incident to a crime report.
David?
Yeah, Convener, it's hard to say when would be the best, what would be the best benchmark for an official investigation. And obviously, I know the Minister had said when a crime reference number is raised, And that could well be, you know, that's certainly an option. I think we've all, there are issues. We could potentially raise a crime report, though, but after some investigation, it's established there is indeed no crime. So a crime report can be no crime, is the terminology we use in the police, at which point a crime report is then basically written off. So there are added complications with that as well. It doesn't seem like there's going to be an ideal you know, time at which to declare an official investigation. I think no matter when it's chosen, there's going to be, you know, a potential element of dubiety around it.
Okay, I've got Mike, Ross, and then I think Susan.
Yeah, convener. From our point of view, as Kevin said, it's when you've got a suspicion, because a lot of the jobs we get, we turn up and you go, right, there's nothing here, there's no crime involved, whatever. We don't issue crime numbers, obviously. In the scenario that's getting in place, the nearest we would get to it is if we've applied for a Scottish criminal record number because we've got sufficient evidence to report to the fiscal. That would be the closest it would be for us because we don't have that crime classification.
But once again, for clarity, when someone phones up and says, I've suspicion that something has taken part, does that trigger a crime number? And is that sufficient to then potentially lead to Nature Scott suspending or revoking a licence? I think that's the context that we're in. Sorry, I've forgotten. Kevin, were you coming in and then Ross? Ross, sorry.
There's more information provided in the document that I just quoted. So it gives some kind of information as to when a crime number would generally be reported. So if someone is able to provide an approximate date or date range of the alleged offence, an approximate locus, or if a modus operandi can be established, then that would generally result in a crime number being afforded. I think the point that we'd make on this is that the Wildlife Management and Muirburn Bill for the licensing schemes for grouse shooting, Muirburn, and for certain wildlife traps has got a provision that says that a licence can be suspended or revoked so long as the regulator is satisfied to the civil burden of proof, that's on the balance of probabilities, that a relevant offence has been committed. Surely that is sufficient to achieve the policy aim. What we're talking about is a reduction in the burden of proof that is required to be able to suspend someone's licence. We've gone away from the criminal burden of proof. We're talking about the civil burden of proof now. Nature Scott would have the capacity, as long as they were satisfied to the civil burden, to suspend or revoke somebody's licence because of a relevant offence. Individual has committed a relevant crime. I would really hope that that would be sufficient and addresses the policy aim. I do not see a circumstance where suspension, where the regulator isn't satisfied of a relevant offence having been committed, being warranted in any circumstance. And I just want to kind of set that out. But again, that document that I referenced in the first instance, convener, could potentially be quite instructive for the committee's deliberations.
Thank you. Susan.
Thanks, convener. This isn't an issue in terms of detail that we looked at as part of the review process. It was more about the direction of travel. And I think it is something which, you know, the different options will need to be explored as part of the protocols which are put in place.
So my thoughts at the moment that we have nothing like enough information to inform the committee on whether we're supportive of this measure, given that there's no detail on the ground. And from what we hear, there appears to be a lot that needs to be on the face of the bill. You know, one thing that jumps out to me is if an SSPCA officer was to question someone who may be a suspect, do they need to be cautioned? And if they're cautioned, does that then add more weight to being an official investigation, which could then lead to Nature Scott suspending a licence? That's a concern. Ian?
Yeah, I think legally speaking, there is different definitions of suspicion. There is a level of suspicion that requires, well, that leads to a police officer's SSPCA attending at an address, but then there is a legal definition of when suspicion crystallises that requires someone to be cautioned and advised of their rights. So I think any wording would need to be very detailed and very prescriptive, because general terms like suspicion carry different meanings to different organisations, and yeah, I think we need to be cautious with that.
So just going back on that, surely SSPCA would then have to have training on to which point cautioning somebody would be appropriate, because we've heard from Mike that the police can't always respond in a timely manner to some wildlife crimes. How would that work in practice? Mike?
That's the exact scenario that the badger baiting case we were talking about. The concern's been raised with you, so you've got your suspicion, you go there and verify that what's being claimed is true, you can identify that to the accused, and that's when you've got to caution some. As soon as we think you must be cautioned, you've got to be given your rights. So we already do that.
It's widely a common pitfall for any reporting agency, this legal definition of when suspicion crystallises, and there are plenty of cases reported to us where there may be admissions made by an accused person where we consider that they should have been cautioned before that point. And that is a risk, and again, the mitigation of that risk comes from sufficient training to make sure that's done properly.
Can I at this point bring in Ian Thompson from RSPB? You know, we often hear about raptors being found the roadside and whatever. What's your involvement in this, and how do you think SSPCA powers could lead to more prosecutions? Or
I've worked on the sort of front line of wildlife crime investigation in Scotland for coming on for 17 years. And RSPB, as an RSPB employee, we don't have any powers. I'm just a member of a public, and members of the public have been mentioned a few times in this session. As a member of the public who occasionally receives reports from other members of the public, or occasionally me or my team comes across potential evidence of wildlife crime, we regularly report these incidents to Police Scotland under current circumstances if an animal is dead, or if we receive a report that an animal is suffering, then our first port of call would be to the SSPCA, because our primary objective is to have that animal treated or euthanised. One of the key things that we found over many, many years working in this is the importance of partnership working. And SSPCA, in our view, bring considerable added value to wildlife crime investigations, often because they have a resource that Police Scotland don't necessarily have. In my view, with regard to police officers who are experienced in investigating wildlife crime cases, at the moment there are probably about a dozen who are regularly doing wildlife crime investigations and taking to the level of reporting them to the Procurator Fiscal in the whole of Scotland. And I think the increased powers offered by the proposals increase the potential that wildlife criminals will be detected and potentially prosecuted. And I think that has a significant deterrent value above and beyond everything else that's been said today.
Thank you. Ross Young.
Convener, just to add, I suppose, an alternative view on this, one of the things that we've got real concerns about is the ability of the Scottish SPCA to operate under a clear presumption of innocence, and that was obviously something that was alluded to in Susan Davies's report. As part of kind of our research before this session today, I actually again consulted with 129 land managers to find out, you know, how many of them had actually trust and confidence in the Scottish SPCA being able to investigate wildlife crime in an impartial and an unbiased way. So we surveyed 129 people in total, and the people that said no to do you have trust and confidence in the Scottish SPCA was 97%, and only 1% said yes. So I do want to just highlight that there is that concern, I think, about the presumption of innocence, and that needs to really be there and established within, I think, these protocols. It's really, really important that we have that, and I just wanted to put that on the record, Convener.
Ian Thompson.
One thing I would say is almost some of the conversations here are as if we're thinking of the SSPCA as an organisation that's coming to this completely new, that has never dealt with evidence, with reporting cases to the Procurator Fiscal. And the Scottish Government, I don't have a copy in front of me, but the Scottish Government's annual wildlife crime report details the number of cases the SSPCA has been involved in. Now, there are more qualified people around the table than I am to see how many cases are reported to the Crown Office every year. But SSPCA is not new at doing this, so it is dealing with investigations into criminals, including some who are committing wildlife offences. And I think that's an important point to make.
OK, thank you. David Lynn.
So, And please feel free to correct me if anyone has a different take on it. From the Minister's evidence and from kind of reading over the proposal, it sounds like this is meant to kind of supplement Police Scotland and assist Police Scotland. And I think the overall kind of aim is to provide that evidence to Police Scotland for us to then take it further. So I think that's where it becomes slightly different from Ian's point. So the SSPCA aren't dealing with something from start to finish potentially with this. They're going to do the initial work and then potentially pass it to us, I think is the intention. So we are then basically relying on the integrity of that work for our further investigations. And as I said earlier on, that's just where it becomes a bit more complicated, because any potential kind of missteps at that point could then have an impact on the wider police investigation, by which point some recent investigations have picked up speed. They've grown hugely. It started out as a relatively kind of minor incident, and you know, it can turn into an incident where you've got numerous accused persons and it's a massive case. So I suppose that's where it becomes slightly different. It's not just the SSPCA that are going to be dealing with something from start to finish. So any kind of misstep would be theirs to deal with. It could potentially have wider implications in terms of, you know, our following investigations and inquiries.
Susan.
Yeah, I think the only other point that I would add at this is that the decision to prosecute is, of course, not sitting with the SSPCA or Police Scotland. It's sitting with the Crown Office, and that's the ultimate control in this on the basis of the standard of the evidence and the quality of that that is presented.
Okay, thank you. Ian.
Yeah, I think one thing to highlight is that ultimately, if we're talking about the SSPCA's impartiality and sort of the presumption of innocence, that ultimately comes down to an assessment of their credibility and reliability. Now, that assessment is ordinarily carried out at the end, at a trial, by the decision maker, whether that's a sheriff or a jury. Our test is to assess if there's sufficient evidence and then apply the public interest test. And I think it was suggested in Susan's report that this sort of impartiality test for SSPCA might happen at the public interest sort of assessment from our point of view. Now, every case comes down to its own facts and circumstances, but I would suggest that in general terms that wouldn't be. I think it's unlikely that we would not take proceedings on a case because it has been investigated by the SSPCA and there is wider concerns about their impartiality or things like that. So, I think in general terms, it would get through our public interest test, and then it's ultimately a matter for the decision maker at a trial. And, you know, I think there is a reasonable anticipation that the defence in a case would found upon that point and would robustly question SSPC officers on that point, and I think that's something to be anticipated that could affect the outcome of cases.
Okay. It's probably an appropriate point to bring Rachel Hamilton, who's got further questions on the protocol that needs to exist between the Scottish SPCA and Police Scotland.
Yeah, well, first of all, I just wanted to say that we won't see this protocol as part of this bill, and think everybody does understand that, and I've got concerns about the extension of the SSP powers if the provisions are granted in the bill, and we haven't seen those protocols. Will the SSPCA be able to use those extended powers and without a protocol? So that's sort of my first point. But the protocol itself, we want to understand what will actually be in the protocol and what will be part of the agreed standards. It has been touched on slightly, but I mean, who's the best person to speak to?
Kick off with David, but actually Susan might be the most appropriate to have looked at this to kick off.
Thank you. So I think in the report, what we set out was that, you know, it's the issues around the training, it's issues around the standard of evidence that has to be gathered, the trigger points for notifying the police as well. All of those sorts of things which have been touched on this morning would need to be picked up within the protocol. I think as well, in terms of that sort of investigation power that would be extended to the SSPCA if it was granted, it's very much given to an individual inspector. And so there is a review process which goes in place as well. And if someone is found not to be conforming to the protocol, then that power can be removed from that individual. So it's not an organisational consent as such, it's more to the individual. And again, I think that just needs to be, you know, very clearly set out as another safeguard in the process.
Okay, so can I just pick up on that? So if there was, if the protocol included training, and the training involved some of the training that would need to be done by the SSPCA to take an investigation further, what would be the unintended consequences if the SSP were given those powers to investigate without the police, which that's the current situation, because crucial aspects of an investigation are currently out of their reach, and the Police Scotland have actually been slightly concerned about this. So if a protocol was set, would that be covered by the review of the individual? Perhaps they were overreaching or not carrying out their functions in the standard that was expected. What are the unintended consequences of this going undetected?
I'm not sure that it would go undetected. Ultimately, you know, they're going to have to follow a set of protocols. They're going to have to gather and preserve evidence in a certain way. And they're going to, through the agreement with the police, have the discussion about how that needs to be presented and handed over. And I think it's been alluded to earlier on today as well that there has to be timescales around that too. There is already exceptionally good partnership working between Police Scotland and the SSPCA and others within the, you know, the wider partnership for wildlife crime. And so these are an extension of some protocols which are already in place, you know, under the powers that Mike and his team already have under the Animal Welfare Act. So I don't think there are a huge number of unintended consequences. I think the safeguard of giving an individual that right to you know, follow up on the evidence and having the ability to withdraw that if issues are raised by Police Scotland and are sort of considered under the protocol, then I think you've got the safeguards in place. There are not too many unintended consequences there.
Okay. David, just on the parts that were highlighted by Police Scotland in previous evidence around their concerns around this, do you have any concerns about how robust the protocols will be and how that, you know, the standards and the training and everything else will be met by your partnership agreement?
Well, ultimately, we won't be able to agree to a protocol unless we feel it's suitable and it meets its purpose, ultimately, is the bottom line. So I don't think, to say we'd be concerned about the protocol, I mean, we couldn't really agree to a protocol unless everyone was happy with its contents. For me, as I said before, the key part about this is it's really quite basic communication. So notification will be absolutely key for Police Scotland. So we want to know, I know it may not always be possible because it will obviously be, SSPC will be on land in their existing powers, but we want to know before, during or immediately after these powers are exercised. So we can then make decisions based on where the inquiry is going to go, where the investigation is going to go, what needs to be done, what has been done. That will be absolutely key. So that will be probably the key part of the protocol as far as I'm concerned. I know all these other things are crucial as well. But if we are cited on something, we can then make decisions. Because without that communication, in theory, with an increase in powers like this, in theory, the SSPCA could be on land on existing powers, see wildlife crime, you know, as kind of specified in the list in the proposal, seize evidence, deal with it entirely and report it to fiscal without any police involvement whatsoever. In theory, minus things like a police interview, obviously, but you know, an official kind of police suspect interview. But in theory, that could happen. So communication is absolutely key, and that notification is really important because there could be unintended consequences with that. You know, I don't think the purpose of the proposal is to afford SSPCA that much power to be able to run with a full investigation from start to finish. But that's potentially the power they will be given if the agreement between ourselves isn't very, very clear.
Jim Fairley.
Thanks, Convener. I'm going to ask this question to yourself, Susan, and Mike and David, and a very straightforward question. Susan, you just said that there is a very good working relationship between Police Scotland and SSPCA at the moment. So what is the need for the extra power?
The need for the extra power is quite simply that if the SSPCA arrive on the land and the animal is dead, they have no powers to act and to gather that evidence. That evidence, if the Police Scotland can't get there quickly, could be lost. So it gives them the power to act on that evidence if the animal is dead.
Okay, and Mike, you would agree that that's...
That's the essence of it, because we have been there, we have contacted Police Scotland, and for whatever reason, somebody has not been available. And we've had to walk away, so the evidence can get damaged by the weather, can disappear, can whatever. It's a kind of a fail-safe, just that gap that's missing, because there is no issue between the Scottish SPCA and the police who we work with on a daily basis on a range of things.
David?
Yeah, the relationship between the police and the SSPCA is generally good. We have kind of issues that you'll have between any two agencies working together. At times maybe communication isn't great and things can fall by the wayside, but generally speaking the relationship is good.
Powers would have to be very limited.
I believe so, yes. Police Scotland's view is the increase in power should be purely just, if the increase is going to happen at all, we are generally kind of opposed to it, but if the increase is to happen at all, it should just be at those initial stages, you know, and that would meet the kind of concerns that have been highlighted about seizing evidence then and there and not having to wait for the police. Okay. But again, as I said earlier on, though, this increase in powers could potentially lead to, you know, unintended consequences of, you know, in reality, affording them far more power than maybe was intended.
OK. Thank you, Kimmy.
Can I just follow on that? So we've got nothing in front of us at all. We've got a direction of travel. Can I ask Susan specifically, should there be far more detail in the face of the bill around the additional powers, the requirements, the safeguards that we might need to put in place? So, some of the just looking for the right independent scrutiny of SSPCA, given the hugely increased potential impact of even a initiation of an investigation resulting in the loss of a licence or whatever. Should there be a lot more on the face of the bill than just a guidance or a protocol that's as part, not even of secondary legislation? Should that detail be on the face of the bill?
I don't think it's required on the face of the bill. I think having that code of practice and the working protocols is sufficient to provide the safeguards which are required. I think it comes back to the question that you posed to the Minister the other day as well, Convener, which is whether the additional powers should be enacted before those protocols are in place. And there is already a good understanding, a good relationship between these partners. I don't see that it should take a huge amount of time and effort to actually put the protocol in place and to agree that.
OK. Ross Young.
Thanks, Convener. I mean, I think just to pick up on a point that we were a little bit concerned about reading through Susan Davies's review, I mean, paragraph 30 makes reference to the fact that Police Scotland and the National Wildlife Crime Unit expressed concern that extending powers to the Scottish SPCA could result in wider crime investigations being disrupted. And to us, you know, we're all committed to tackling wildlife crime and getting it to the absolute lowest levels possible. And to me, when we were reading that particular paragraph, and indeed the police's evidence that they submitted actually to this committee, I mean, it's pretty excoriating. And our worry is that actually we could be compromising potentially some wildlife crime investigations if, as we've said and set out, this protocol isn't really watertight and ironed out. So I think we just really would emphasise the importance of getting that protocol right.
OK, thank you. David Lynn.
Again, early and effective communication could negate that. You know, if we are notified of the exercising these additional powers at a very early stage, that could negate any damage to any wider police investigation. Ultimately.
Kevin Kelly.
Thank you, Convener. And the report as well, that predates my time there, and I've looked at that. I don't necessarily share the views from the NWCU at that time and would like to move forward looking at working in partnership. It goes back to my opening comment around governance and managing the risk around it, which is where I see the issues here is what's policing's appetite for risk. If we get this right via what's the MOU, what's the pathway to delivery look like, then is it trialable to work? But without that, there's too much risk to policing to be able to say we will.
OK, thanks. There's one little piece of information I want to get on record because the response I got wasn't quite clear from Mike. So I'm going to read this out to make sure I'm being clear. So if the SSPCA was to respond to a call about a live animal caught in a trap, under its powers under the 2006 Act, but the animal died before the inspector arrived at the scene, would the current proposals enable an approved inspector then to enter land to gather evidence of a suspected wildlife crime?
Asking me what the potential might happen.
Would the new powers, as you understand them, allow you to enter the land to gather evidence?
Well, I'm not trying to be obtrusive, but we would know. And as I explained before, I think it was in the previous session, the animal actually died while we were standing there.
Yes, I think that's the point. Would the direction of travel the legislation is taken at the moment, if you were to get a call about a live animal and if you arrived and it was dead, would it currently allow you to then undertake a collection of evidence?
I would say yes in that instance. If it's somebody phoning us up saying there's a dead raptor up a hill and it's been there for 6 months.
No, it's live.
Phone Police Scotland.
You're right, okay. Okay. Susan, is that your understanding?
Yeah, I mean, my understanding at the moment is that if the SSPCA gets a call about a live animal and it arrives and that animal is dead, they are very limited in what they can do. So this power would give them more scope to then investigate that.
Gather evidence. Okay, that's helpful.
Just to David Lynn, we're in new territory with this new protocol. If somebody had their licence suspended on the basis of an investigation that had been carried out through the agreed protocol that we haven't seen, Would that individual have the ability to appeal against the process that had been carried out within the protocol if they believed that the protocol hadn't been followed?
Well, I suppose it's hard to say without a protocol being in place at the moment and knowing what the kind of legal obligations are in terms of that. I mean, if it's not going to be on the bill, then yeah. I imagine it'd be quite difficult to kind of raise any issues with it. You know, if the protocol or the detail within the protocol is not contained on the bill itself, then I don't know how you could really take issue with just basically what is a kind of standard operating procedure between two agencies. I don't know is the honest answer.
Okay.
Very, very brief last comments. I've got Susan, Ross and Ian.
Just in relation to that point, I think you're talking about a licence which Nature Scotland would be issuing. In that situation, it would have to go back to Nature Scotland for review. Now, obviously, I can't speak for Nature Scotland. I have worked for them in the past, and there is a process that they would go through, A, to look at any evidence which was presented for revoking a licence, or if something happened that suggested that that had been the wrong course of action. But that would be a Nature Scotland issue for their internal procedures to be in place to cover that.
Okay, Ross.
Just a small correction, Convener, because the right to appeal in the context of the Grouse-Shute licence is actually to the Sheriff Court, so it would be them that would make the determination of any appeal that was made. And on that, they'd be looking at everything on fact and law. So that would be the mechanism through which it would happen. I think we would then reiterate, you know, I think the right to appeal is comprehensively undermined if the regulator actually doesn't need to be satisfied that a relevant offence has been committed. You've sort of got no avenues then or no evidence that you can throw back if you do want to go down an appeal, if that is the low baseline, you know, without proof that they're essentially setting as being the mechanism for licence suspension.
Okay. Ian Thompson.
Yeah, Susan Davis made the point that I was going to make. So.
Okay. Very briefly.
Could we write to the Minister on this specific point? Because there's still some dubiety in my mind around how that would work.
Yeah, I think there's still some questions around what constitutes an official investigation as it's on the bill at the moment, and what involvement Nature Scotland would have in deciding whether a crime had been committed. So we can certainly write for a little bit more clarification. I would like to thank you all very much. That's been a really productive and interesting session, and it'll help us in our deliberations further down the line. So thank you all for your time today. That concludes our business for today, and I formally close this meeting.